Thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on LocalGov TV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments. Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
All right, if you could please come to order. This is the January 22nd, 2019 meeting of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners, and all five of the commissioners are present. So, Commissioner Carter, if you would please lead us in the invocation and the Pledge of Allegiance.
Father God, as we come before you tonight, dear Lord, we pray that you give us a heart to listen, wisdom and courage to do the business of the county and the citizens, and to do it in the right way, dear Lord, to help them the most. We ask, Father, for your guidance to each and every one of us. Give us safety in tonight. Give us safety in the morning, dear Lord, with the weather that's coming. All this we ask, dear Father, in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Stand for the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, we've got a few public speakers signed up for tonight. Before we get started with the public comment time, I'm going to just take a moment to review very briefly the public comment policy, which was adopted as revised by the Alamance County Board of Commissioners in September 2014. The comment period is limited to a maximum of 30 minutes. Then there'll be a commissioner response period immediately following the public comment period so that the commissioners can respond to comments that have been made. It's not a time for debating with the public. Each person desiring to speak during the public comment period shall have 3 minutes to make his or her remarks. It's kind of like the shot clock in college basketball. When the horn goes off, the play stops and they give the ball to the other team if it hadn't touched the rim. I'm familiar with that. There should be no more than 3 speakers on any one topic per meeting. That is interpreted to say that 3 speakers in favor of one agenda item and then 3 speakers who want to speak in opposition to an agenda item. It is recommended that speakers desiring to speak on the same topic and advocating the same position choose one person to speak for all. Speakers, please address the board from the lectern at the front of the room and begin your remarks by stating your name and address. That helps our clerk when she does the minutes for the meeting to keep the minutes accurately. And if a speaker has a disabling condition that needs accommodation, if you would let us know that 24 hours in advance, then we'll be happy to try to accommodate that request. Please be courteous in language and presentation. And then there's some common sense stuff like don't cuss, don't use racial slurs, and don't attack anybody personally. And then during the meeting, the audience would please refrain from making unsolicited comments. This is from the rules of procedure that were adopted by the Alamance County Board of Commissioners, I think in March 2017. Audience in Article 6, Section 7, Decorum of Audience, it says, audience members refrain from making unsolicited comments during the meeting. During speakers from the floor or debate by the board, audience members shall refrain from conduct which disrupts the proceeding. And please silence your cell phones and other electronic devices during the meeting. So, all that being said, we will start the public comment period with Micah Wilkerson. If you would please come.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Just read for my remarks. Chairwoman Galen, County Commissioners, appreciate the opportunity to speak to you this evening on an area of concern affecting people in the rural areas of our county, an issue known as rural broadband divide. Recently, in reviewing my options to upgrade my broadband connection in the southern part of the county, I had only two viable options. A, to keep my current connection service with AT&T, 6 megabits per second DSL connection, or B, switch to a satellite internet provider such as HughesNet or Exceed, which cap how much data one can use at a high speed, typically 20 gigabytes a month. Spectrum, formerly known as Time Warner Cable, is not available in my part of the county, and in my conversation with them, they would not solicit requests for installation of lines to rural homes. In their defense, it's very cost prohibitive to installing service that where it's not already installed in the ground. 6 megabits per second, which is the max AT&T will provide over DSL, does not allow for multiple devices on a home network to stream video. Without a proper broadband connection, it makes it difficult for rural communities to start or run a modern business, access telemedicine, take online courses, digitally transform their farms, or research a school project, for some examples. This dilemma plays out in the Bureau of Labor Statistics employment data, which shows highest unemployment rates are frequently located in counties with the lowest availability of broadband. I come to you this evening with a few questions and kindly request for your consideration. Number one, you currently have an internet speed survey on the front page of the county website soliciting feedback from citizens on their connectivity in their homes. I was wondering how much longer this survey would be running on the website, and once completed, what would be done with the responses that you collect. My second question was, would it be possible for representatives from some of these internet providers, such as Spectrum, AT&T, or these satellite providers, if they'd be if it would be possible for them to come to a future commissioners meeting and provide an update on their plans to expand their service offering to rural citizens in the county. Thank you again for your opportunity to speak, and I look forward to your responses. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Mr. Wilkerson also reminded me that if you have written comments and you would like to submit them to the clerk, you can do that as well. Ben Painter. Did I pronounce that correctly?
Thank you, Commissioners, for allowing the opportunity to speak. I'd like to address the need for a firearms safety ordinance in the county. My wife and I purchased our home 2 years ago in the Saxpaw area in hopes that we could contribute to the activities occurring in Alamance County that make it vibrant and livable. Since we have lived in the home, our neighbor has begun accelerating shooting on his property that falls outside the realm of target practice for hunting or sport. The shooting is erratic and so loud that my wife and I are unable to have a conversation inside of our own house. We feel unsafe on our property and limit our time outside because of the nuisance noise and the fear of injury or death by an errant bullet. I've spoken with my neighbor about the use of his firearm, and he has responded in a confrontational manner, stating that he has the right to use his gun however and whenever he wants. I've spoken with the Sheriff's Department, and although they are sympathetic to our concerns, they have no grounds for enforcement. Our property usage has been limited, and the value of our home is impacted because of the nuisance shooting. We no longer have guests over in the daytime, including friends and family. And there's a young family with infants that live on the other side of the neighbor's property, seemingly in the direction that he fires the weapon, and we worry about their safety. I've spoken with the Sheriff Deputy Cliff Parker about our situation, and he told me that there have been other cases in the county that are similar to ours. So I'm not up here just to complain about my neighbor or to recommend banning firearms in the county. I'm representing current and future residents who want to live in Alamance County to enjoy the peace and safety of rural small community living. Hunting is a popular activity, and the right to defend your home with a firearm is important for many residents. However, the right to firearm ownership and usage needs to be balanced with the right to peace and safety for the residents of the county. It's possible to pass ordinance that limit the use of firearms where it affects another citizen's right to feel safe in their own homes and to preserve the value of their own property. I encourage the commissioners to read over the examples of ordinance that have passed for firearm safety in other North Carolina counties. Alamance County has a higher population density than other counties that have passed ordinances. These are rural counties that have a desire to own and use firearms that have passed these ordinances permitting firearms, but also ensuring the right to a safe and nuisance-free environment for all citizens. Examples include not permitting the use of firearms within 1,000 feet of a dwelling or other building or structure that is designed to be occupied by human beings. I respectfully request that the commissioners pass an ordinance that protects the safety and peace of Alamance County residents from the nuisance and unsafe use of firearms, and I've provided a few handouts that are examples of ordinance passed in other NC counties comparable to the demographic and cultural values of Alamance that could provide a template for the similar ordinance that works for our citizens. A draft for what an ordinance for Alamance could look like is also included. Thank you, and I'll get these to you somehow.
You'll hand those to
you. Can just give them to the county manager.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Payne. Brittany Ball? Is Brittany Ball here? Is she in the other, is there other people in the other floor room?
We do.
Can you check in there, please? So I'm here to talk about the percent of owner-occupied housing. It's currently lower than the national average and continues to lower while rent continues to increase at a much larger rate than wages. This was a couple of years ago, but over the course of 1 year, Alamance County had a 3.34% increase in wages, while the average asking price for a home increased by 30%. So the average income of an Alamance County resident is about a little over $23,000 a year, or $1,944 a month. So a good rule of thumb is not to allow your rent to exceed 30% of income, but that would mean that those making that $1,944 or less each month would need to rent a home for $600 or less, but the median rent price in Alamance County is $925. So the median price of a house in Alamance County is $146,000. Imagine how difficult it is to save for a down payment of almost $30,000 when half of one's earnings needs to go towards rent. I do understand the negative effects of rent controls and regulations. However, I do believe there has to be some way to prohibit landlords from rent gouging and adding excessive fees. So my question is, what is a realistic solution to the disparity of income and housing costs?
Thank you
for your time. Laura Johnson. Is Laura Johnson in the overflow area? Can somebody check, please?
Hi, so my name is Laura Johnson. I'm from Snow Camp, and I'm here to talk about some of the proposed changes to the heavy industrial use ordinance. I know it's a topic that's been sort of brought up a lot lately. It has a special interest to Snow Camp because of the situation we're in right now with the quarry. There are some proposed changes that are coming forward from the planning board that really only pass the buck in terms of who has to sign off and gives a little bit of notice to the county or to the residents in the area, but doesn't really give us any say or any sort of meaningful impact on the outcome of the situation. A group of us have put together, looking at the current ordinance, have put together a list of proposed asks or changes to that ordinance. it's 3 pages long, so I'm not going to read every single one of them, but the gist is that this ordinance really pretty much is very passive, and it's pretty much a checklist. And as long as you meet those items on the checklist, then it moves on to the next level where the state is really the one who makes the decision for our county. What we are asking for and looking for is something that puts more of the decision making in our county, gives more protections or equal protections to the citizens in balance with the businesses. We realize that these type of companies and the things that are covered under the ordinance, you know, would bring other income and other jobs to the county. However, they also affect the communities, ruin property values, affect health and safety and things like that. So there's got to be a balance. And we feel really strongly that there has to be more thought put into it at the county level. We need to make the decision if it's something we want, not simply did this industry mark off all the check boxes, but if is this in accordance with where we want our county to go, where we want our future to go, what the impact is going to be. And so what we're asking for in these changes are those sort of things, things that really put the decision-making process more at the county level, and then protects us as citizens. And so, like I said, I'm not going to read every single one of them because it's 3 pages long, but they're just some suggestions that we have as changes to the ordinance. And we ask that, you know, beyond the 2 changes that are being considered tonight, that it's taken further and we really rewrite this ordinance to protect ourselves. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Who do I pass on to?
The man of the house.
Right there.
They're not.
He's
collected. Thank you very
much. Thank you.
Thank you. Donna Poe.
Mm-hmm. Good evening. Good evening and Happy New Year.
Yep.
My comment is concerning agenda item number 2, a heavy industrial development ordinance moratorium. My name is Donna Poe, and I live at 1907 Quakenbush Road in Snow Camp, neighbor to the Alamance Quarry you are all now quite aware of. While we, the citizens of Snow Camp and surrounding communities, remain optimistic that the state will deny the mining application because of its way too many risks, we are also requesting that the HIDO be revised during a moratorium period to not allow another perfect storm due to a flawed ordinance make landfall again within our county. At the 12-13 Planning Board meeting, the process for enacting a moratorium was discussed. The first option, a shorter length, 59 days or less, we were told would apparently not require a public hearing. The second option, 60 days or longer, would require a public hearing with a 10-day prior newspaper notice. So out of a need for urgency, we encouraged the planning board members to recommend option number 1, of which was unanimously approved, and we would just roll the dice hoping nothing slipped in prior to the January commissioners meeting vote tonight, and that the ordinance would be revised within a 59-day period. However, we've since learned that a public hearing is required for both options, with a 3-day difference in public notification between the 2 term lengths, according to legislation statutes 153A-340 and 323. And it is not specified as to how long after the public hearing the moratorium is formally approved and set into place. It was later noted in the statutes without reviewing that no public hearing is required for a moratorium in cases of imminent and substantial threat to public health or safety. We believe this is the current situation, as exampled in the recent response by Colonial Pipeline. I believe, Commissioner Sutton, you finally received a copy of that. Okay. Along with the comments of the next 2 speakers concerning groundwater issues and questionable applicants. The agenda item for this evening was to discuss a 59-day moratorium with a public hearing scheduled for February 4th. My questions are, can a longer moratorium be discussed and voted on tonight? We do not want the moratorium to expire before the HIDO revision process is complete. And then number 2, will a public hearing be required with the present conditions being a threat to public health and safety? We do not want to gamble and have any more HIDO applications slip in under this inadequate ordinance while waiting for an extended moratorium process. Thank you for your time, your consideration, and your care.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Thank you. What's the word on this?
Well, if I may interrupt, we've got an agenda item related to the whole thing. So we're going to have a very thorough discussion, I expect, with that.
Thank you.
Okay, great. Gary, you'll lick me. I know
he's in there.
Okay. If somebody can fetch that tree, you lick me.
I got banished to the kids' table. So, yeah. Good evening. My name is Gary Lickney, and I reside at 845 Soapstone Trail in Snow Camp. I'd like to be sure that the commissioners are aware that on January 9th, 2019, Alamance Aggregates, which is the company proposing to build a mine in Snow Camp, was served with a notice of violation from the North Carolina Department of Environmental Quality for operating a mine without a permit, as required by North Carolina General Statute 74-56. Sorry, I have a cold. Despite clear guidelines in the Mining Act that no land disturbance, tree removal, etc. is permitted before the mining permit is approved and a reclamation bond is paid, Alamance Aggregates chose to begin construction. They were ordered to cease construction and immediately install sediment control measures around the disturbed areas. The violation is subject to a $5,000 per day civil penalty for any continuing violation. The violation was first reported to DEQ by a concerned citizen, and DEQ sent out an inspector to review the construction. One can only speculate how long the construction would have continued had the violation not been reported. Of concern to the community is if Alamance Aggregates cannot abide by state law prior to the permit even being approved, what will they do once the mine is operational? We have very little confidence in their commitment and ability to follow regulations that will protect the health and safety of Snow Camp residents, and urge the commissioners to adopt regulations in the new ordinance that fully vet applicants to determine their past criminal and regulatory history, and most importantly, their experience and safety record in previous operations. If the applicant is part of a larger corporation, there should be full disclosure and transparency. No applicant should be permitted to submit an application anonymously. And I'll be emailing a copy of the actual violation letter to commissioners so you can review it. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Jane Hicks.
My name is Jane Lee Hicks, and I reside at 1730 Quakenbush Road in Snow Camp. When Alamance County issued an intent to construct permit for a mining quarry that plans to pump 500,000 gallons of water daily from the aquifer, I became concerned about the impact on my well, which is just 2,500 feet away from the proposed mine site. In reviewing the county ordinances that relate to water conservation, I was surprised to learn that there is nothing to protect our groundwater from contamination or depletion by industry. There are 2,500 households in the community of Snow Camp. An average daily consumption of water for a household is about 80 to 100 gallons. If we use 100 gallons for simplicity and easy math, then the entire community consumes 250,000 gallons of water per day. The permitted mine would extract two times that amount every day. If you consider the 120 households in a 2-mile radius who are most likely to share the same aquifer as the mining site, then the quantity we consume is 120,000 gallons per day. The mine would be consuming more than four times the total daily pumping volume drawn from our groundwater every single day. This would be a disaster in the making if those wells were contaminated or catastrophically drawn down by this mining operation. Now you see why so many of us are losing sleep every night worrying about losing access to our water. I believe that all citizens of Alamance County have a right to clean drinking water, not just those in the designated critical watersheds, which are protected by the watershed ordinance. No one should lose sleep over losing their access to clean water. We need an ordinance that would protect drinking water for all citizens of Alamance County, and I urge the commissioners to enforce an immediate moratorium on the heavy industrial development ordinance, which inadvertently allows this imminent risk to our water supply and substantial threat to our public health. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hey, Kristen Powers.
Good evening. My name is Kristen Powers, and I live in Saxbaha. My remarks this evening are regards to a proposal to increase the detention budget by $2.8 million in order to house people detained by the U.S. Marshal and ICE agents. To Tonight, I want to caution against any partnership with ICE, as business leaders and impacted community members have mentioned before. Two courts in Colorado and New York have both condemned ICE jails for unconstitutional practices that often come as a result of partnering with an immigration agency with a problematic history of housing young children in jails and losing track of them and their families, for instance. While this proposal sounds appealing because of the promise of revenue to counter this $2.8 million in spending, it fails to account for potential litigation and harm to the county's reputation should we misstep and fall into the same traps of these other jails. There are many local issues that we should draw our attention to first, especially for $2.8 million. We must take care of our own community before doing the federal government's labor, especially when the federal government will let us take a fall for any mistakes that may occur. Instead, I argue let's spend the first month of this new year imagining what we can invest in to make Alamance County a more beautiful place for all of us to live. Imagine if we used $2.8 million towards a fund to make immediate and necessary repairs to our school buildings, ensuring kids, staff, and teachers attend schools that are healthy and safe. We could repair bathrooms, clean out the mold, improve accessibility, all the boring stuff that makes a real difference when you spend 8+ hours of your day in a building. Imagine if we use that $2.8 million to reassess salaries for county employees, including deputies and jail staff, ensuring Alamance County has competitive wages that allow our employees to go home with enough to feed families, pay for school, and go on a well-deserved vacation or two. Imagine a county where we embrace businesses that work to repair environmental harms rather than exploit our lack of zoning ordinances. We need businesses that recognize the Southern Alamance folks, and everybody for that matter, who, as people who deserve to live in communities without blast warnings and without a risk to their buildings and water supply. The $2.8 million could support farmers or folks struggling with utility bills, for instance. We need our county commissioners to embrace this vision in order to protect and expand upon the reasons we all chose to call this wonderful place home. Let us use this $2.8 million to invest in matters that are critical to the well-being of our community. Let us invest in education, competitive wages, and the protection of our land and water. Thank you.
Thank you.
Chris Faust.
Chris Faust, 1851 South Main Street, Graham. I come to you, I'm not for the court, I just want to be sure everybody knows that, because I want to get out of here alive. But I am here for, I'm a developer. Those of you on the other, I come to the council last year just to tell everybody, you know, how good it is to work in Alamance County, and it still is. We've got a new planner, and we, she's new, we're learning each other. But we've put about 350 lots on the ground in the last, since 2013. We've got another 83, I believe, this in TRC this week. I just don't want a knee-jerk reaction from the heavy industrial to the residential. We got enough regulations as it is now. I mean, this, you know, it's everything changes. I just want maybe everybody think about how this is going to be done, sit down and think about it. The heavy industrial, that's a different ball game than residential. So when I seen that in the paper and heard it on radio, I just wanted to, as a residential developer who works well with Alamance County, and it's been great working with Alamance County, that I, you know, I don't want nothing to change. And I know change is coming, but let's just try to make it as easy transition as we can, because like I said, we got enough regulations we have to deal with every day. Thank you.
Thank you. And John Campbell.
Hello.
Hello.
How are you doing?
I'm John Campbell. I live at 7565 Snow Camp Road. If you take Snow Camp Road, if you take the road south from here, you get on 49 or you get on 87, you get on 62, you go down the way there, the houses get further and further apart as you go down. The open space gets more and more as you go down there. There's more cows, there's more woods, there's more farmland. You get down to the south end of the county, or you can take those same roads north, get to the north end of the county. And what's there is this open farm life and this place that we live in. And what I want to say is, what we want in the county is already there. It's already there. You, whatever we do to put something else, whatever's next that comes to us, is going to take away a little bit from that clean water, that open space, that clean air, that green space that's already there. And what we want is what's already there. So as you make your decisions and you figure this out, because it's really hard to do as county commissioners, you got to weigh all these things. Remember that we don't need something else. What we want is already there. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Well,
and that is all the people who have signed up to make comments tonight, and we have 5 minutes to spare for 4 minutes. So, nice. All right, so commissioners' responses. Who wants to go first?
I'd like to ask a question. Did up at Green Level, Barton Marietta, right? Is that where that was? Weren't there some well issues up there as a result of their operations?
I don't know that there were.
Can we check into that?
Sure.
Because they had some blasting, obviously, up there. Something makes me think there were some issues.
I think they were concerned about it, yeah. But I don't know if there was anything said about it.
Can we still check into it?
Sure. I also checked with the mine that's beside Lake McIntosh, too.
Of course, most of those people ended up getting city water, so
sure.
That's a whole different situation.
Anybody else have anything?
So I just kind of have a question for one of our last speakers there, Kristen Powers. Is she expecting us to use $2.8 million, which we won't get unless we rent the bed space, right, Sheriff? She wants us to use it for something else, and we don't get it unless we rent the bed space to those two agencies. I don't think she's really paid attention to this issue.
Yeah, I think there's a fundamental misunderstanding there about what the sheriff proposes to do.
But we're not just going to hand him $2.8 million tonight. I'm sorry, Sheriff.
Yeah, right. The expectation is that ICE is going to pay $2.8 million plus hopefully some extra to compensate Alamance County for its time and trouble. And the extra would be able to be used for the things that she listed.
And that's what capacity we already have.
Or other things.
Do have a question on the gentleman that was speaking about folks shooting next to him.
Yeah.
Have y'all responded to that situation, I'm guessing?
Yes, sir. Mr. Boswell, there needs to be some teeth in our noise and ordinance.
It absolutely does.
It says at discretion of the officer, well, you may have five different officers answering different calls, and each one of them gives the people a different reason or concerning the law. I talked to our county attorney, Clyde Albright. There needs to be some teeth there, a time that they can do whatever, you know, or something. I'm a Second Amendment man. I believe that people should have a right to bear arms, but I also believe they should be safe and considerate of their neighbors. And as it is, there's no certain time that you can or can't. And there's nothing anywhere to get a call at 10 o'clock at night, somebody shooting firearms, and the citizens just can't understand that we don't have any, there's no teeth in that ordinance, and we need some teeth in that ordinance so we can deal with that issue.
Is there not a public nuisance ordinance that would deal with that issue?
There's a noise ordinance.
Noise ordinance.
And the noise ordinance,
10 o'clock.
It defines it as a reasonable time and place.
Yeah,
it
says reasonable time and place. I would suggest
to you that most of the ordinances are similar to ours. In Guilford County, Forsyth County, and other counties that are moving from agricultural to more urban development. And I talked to the sheriff about it. I said, I grew up in the country too, and I've got some guns and shotguns, but I don't go outside my house at 11 o'clock at night and unload every shell I've got. And if I did, I would hear from my neighbors.
If they do that in my house, they might get shot.
Well, the point is, I think maybe some training to our deputies and maybe take our ordinance and put what is a reasonable time.
Exactly.
So would that be appropriate for an agenda item at an upcoming meeting for us to consider? Would that, how would that work? Do we, would we discuss that as a board, what we think would be reasonable things, and then you draft the...
I could draft it, and you could consider it as an ordinance. So,
I think we need to look at that.
We would notice it and hear from people like this gentleman we heard from tonight, who's at his wit's end.
Yeah, I think that'd be very good, and have public comment opportunity from people who might disagree and think this, things are good the way they are.
But the whole idea is balancing and what is reasonable.
And showing your neighbors some respect.
Right. Absolutely.
It's hard to legislate common sense sometimes.
Yes, you're right.
So, Mr. Hager, could we make that a agenda item?
Sure.
In the near future. Thank you. Does anybody else have anything? I was going to ask, is Bruce Walker, our head of our information, or our IT department, is he here? Oh, hey, Bruce.
He's always here.
He's always there, that's right.
I believe, if I'm not mistaken, that you were kind of spearheading that internet speed survey. Can you address the gentleman's concerns
about
that?
So, you know, we drafted, it's been a long process, but one of the things we thought, what can we do? I mean, there's not much we can do because it is private business and those kinds of things. And we're considered by the FCC a tier one county, which means we actually have, according to them, good internet access comparatively to other counties. And so there's different grants and bonds and that kind of thing, but they're only qualified to tier three and tier two counties that have it worse than us. There's been an ongoing debate in Washington whether internet access is a utility. That has been firmly defeated in Washington as of this point. But more and more people are using it for different things. I think that will continue to be a debate. So we said, what can we do? We've talked to the private companies, and they share a very basic map and those kinds of things. They don't share a lot of information. And so everybody's kind of on their own when they talk to the individual companies. So we said, well, let's send out a letter with our taxpayers and see if we can do a survey online and promote it and whatever. We've had, I'll be honest, about 1% of the population respond. Now, we were waiting for, you know, everybody knows, well, if you don't know, most people pay their bills, the vast majority pay their tax bills at the end of December, and then there's a couple weeks of stragglers there. And so we were hoping to get, you know, some more and then compile that onto a scatter map that hopefully covers, you know, we have about 1,600 folks that responded, and if we're lucky, it covers the whole county. If it doesn't, I've actually talked to the school system about asking them again. Students are a big part of this issue when they're, again, more and more folks are being asked to do homework and submit them online. And in those situations, they can't review a video or something like that based on those kinds of speeds. So it's a problem for all the counties, and it's a private industry problem. So we're going to hopefully create that map and then give it to the private industry, give it to our state representatives, and then send it to the FCC to say, hey, are you sure you qualified us in the proper tier? And then in addition, hopefully that map will be something better and will showcase areas that really do want higher speed internet. We had some interesting comments. You know, some people have high speed and they have complaints, and then some people, they put a lot of extra things on the survey that we didn't expect. But we're hoping to have a good map, hopefully by the end of this month, and we'll publish, of course, that on the internet. And if we don't feel we have enough folks, we're going to, you know, involve the schools again, because again, a lot of those students are directly affected. They have to drive into town or drive to one of our parks or drive to a business or a McDonald's to do their homework or stay after school, and they may not be able to do that. So it's definitely a problem. We've been paying attention. There's not a lot of things we can do because it's a laissez-faire situation with the businesses, but you know, they want to go to where the profits are. It's very, very expensive to just run a wire, even from a driveway, if you have a half-mile driveway down the road. So, again, that balance. But there are things in the future coming out. I mean, 5G is coming out. Elon Musk is working something for space. So there's a lot of things. Technology is rapidly improving, so we're hoping all those things tie together. But what can we do? We're going to provide a map of where coverage is and then go from there.
Thank you, Bruce.
Sure. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you for that information, and thank you to Mr. Wilkerson for bringing that up tonight, because the broadband access is something that we talk a lot about. It's a very frustrating problem. I'm impacted by it as well. You can check out Exceed, E-X-C-E-D-E. They can do some stuff. That's who we use, I think. But still, it doesn't work if the weather's bad, and if it's snowing or if it's storming, you can't get a signal. It's really giant pain. It's not all about playing Fortnite and Xbox Live. Okay, so moving on to approval of the agenda. If everybody has had opportunity to review the agenda, we have a motion.
Move to approve it.
Second. A motion and a second to approve the agenda. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? All right, the consent agenda. Is there anybody, everybody's had the opportunity to review the items on the consent agenda, you'd have a motion.
I move that we approve them.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve the consent agenda. If there's no discussion, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? All right, now we have a very exciting land use options in Alamance County presentation by Tanya Cattle. And while she's coming up, I wanted to tell the assembly that I asked her to do this tonight because we have so many increasing questions and concerns about land use in Alamance County, and people talk about zoning. People ask, you know, what are the options? What are the ways that we can regulate land use through the heavy industrial ordinance? What other ways? And so this presentation tonight is kind of put our feet on that path to considering whether or not there are things that we want to do this year with this issue.
Okay. I appreciate that. That gives my introduction way away. So we'll get into it. What you see before you on the screens is a map of the county, and the dark colored areas are actual municipalities. The slash lines are what we call their ETJs. ETJs are in the state of North Carolina, the extraterritorial jurisdictions. That means those cities get to plan and control those areas for their future growth. County has no ability to use any restrictions in that area. We would have to, anybody owns property in that area would have to be forwarded to that jurisdiction that they are in their ETJ to get any guidance on any growth or setbacks or anything like that. This is just kind of a visual, shows you what we actually, the areas we can plan. And ETJs can go up to 2 miles outside of the city limits. And it's up to that city how far they want to go out. You can tell some go further, some use a lot less of it. What we're going to talk about tonight is land use control and some abilities of what the county, what that could look like for the county. Our current ordinances, currently we have approximately 36 ordinances are planning related. We really have about 39. I don't consider three of them like noise ordinances, planning ordinances. We've got subdivisions, watershed ordinance, floodplain ordinance. We've all heard about the heavy industrial ordinance. We regulate cell towers, farmland preservation, abandoned vehicles, and abandoned mobile homes. Do a lot of code enforcement on those. Primarily, our ordinances are nuisance driven. At some point over time, we found it to be a problem, so we're an ordinance to try to help the citizens of the county. Ordinances such as zoning, heavy industrial, and subdivision are the day-to-day guidance ordinance written to support and follow up your future growth plan, which is the land development plan. County has that. That was written in 05, updated in 07, so data really goes back to 05. But in response to where the land use plan or land development plan wanted to take us, we drafted these more day-to-day ordinances to help do that. And since that's not implementation plan, it's a guidance plan, a future growth plan. Like I said, land development plan was approved 2007. Alamance County Land Development Plan is a guide for making strategic decisions about the orderly growth and development of our community. Any future plans for zoning or other initiatives have to be explained how they comply with the land development plan, and that's a state law. Plan data, like I said, is only up to date to about 2005, so it's about 14 years old. Any of the options presented need to work from an accurate base, so that land plan, number one priority, needs to be updated before we really look at anything else. Your day-to-day plans are to implement your future plan. If your future plan is 14 years old, it's kind of hard to work with that. So these projects would be ineffective if we don't go ahead and update where we're going in the future from 2019 instead of 2007. Here you're looking at, from the 2007 plan, what the uses were in the county based off tax data. Since we don't have zoning, we wouldn't know specifically what each parcel is. And that's a really long ways away, but I'm going to tell you the yellow is residential. So you're going to see a whole lot of residential on there. You've got some commercial growth and things, but you can also see, general idea, all of our development is beyond the interstate and beyond those cities and beyond their ETJs. The ETJs are the light gray. The dark gray areas are the city jurisdictions. And you'll see, well, you can also see on here, we have a lot of water that we are concerned with and that implements watersheds and floodplains and all that as well. Land use control. Planning is an effort to promote efficiency, equity, and quality of life in the community. It allows the community to get out in front of potential issues that impede quality of life and prepare for growth. It is not an effort to remove right or stifle growth. It's here to implement community goals as described in the county's plan, protect property rights against negative spinoffs of neighboring land use, make land use patterns predictable, ensure cost-effective public services to citizens and minimum public expenditures. You're talking about like your EMA spaces and things where counties can kind of control where they allow growth, and it helps with those kind of capital plans. Protect against negative environmental impacts and set minimum aesthetic and functional standards for development.
Can I interrupt you real quick?
Yes.
I believe we have a very distinguished visitor tonight, right? Dr. Owens, Dr. David Owens is here. Could you introduce him to us, please?
Well, I would be glad to. Clyde knows him very well.
Or Clyde?
Well, he's Professor Owens from the Orange County Law School, also known as Chapel Hill. Graciously agreed to come and answer any questions this board might have, and I believe he has a presentation as well.
Is that from
University next to Carver?
It is.
Uptown Carver.
Thank you very much, Dr. Owens, for being here, and we look forward. I just wanted to make sure that everybody knew that you were here and what you're doing, you know, that you're here to answer questions. And so we're not known for being people who are reluctant to ask questions. So appreciate you being here, making this time available to us.
For planners, she's the Encyclopedia of Planning. That's you open it,
very
you
good.
An honor to have you here.
Absolutely. The land use options, at least if you were going to look at tonight, is that we keep what we have. We'll make no change to our land use controls. Second option is to look at countywide zoning, taking parcel by parcel and looking at zoning. Our third option is zoning by precinct. Fourth option is small area plans. And fifth is land use zones development standards that comes from the land development plan. Option one, no change. Alamance County currently has no zoning on any land in the county. County has no formal parcel specific plan that guides development. We do have lot sizes, setbacks, just some basic plans, but no zoning. If no changes are made to the current ordinance, the county may not have development occur the way they would envision. Option number two, this is the big one. Countywide zoning is an effort to go parcel by parcel and zone the entire county. As y'all saw on the map, there's a lot of acreage to look at this option. This requires a land use inventory of every single parcel within the county. That means actually getting in the car, driving by and seeing what's going on at each piece of land. Very effective at balancing the entire county's future growth. Everybody gets treated the same and we get to see every single piece of the county. This would be in conjunction with the consultant. County staff is staff of two in your planning department. So a staff of two would have a hard time conducting this much at one time. We'll need a committee. Committees usually help guide these plans. Staff and consultant will require multiple public hearings, planning board will review, and board commissioners do a final approval for that. Zoning by precinct. This is funny law just for Alamance County. The zoning would apply to the precinct, not to any other part of the county. So by precincts, 35% of registered voters living in precinct must petition to put their precinct on the ballot to vote a zoning ordinance in for only that precinct. They only get to decide their precinct, but 35% of them that are registered have to decide this. So this is a very step-by-step process, and I hope that citizens get involved at that level. The zoning ordinance would require public hearings, again, planning board review and board of commission approval. This can be requested every 2 years should it fail at any specific time.
So let me ask a question about that one, if I may. When we think about our precinct map, like if you think about Pleasant Grove precinct, there's, I think, part of the extraterritorial jurisdiction for Mebane lies within the Pleasant Grove precinct. So how would that, the people, or there may be people who actually live in Mebane itself who live in the precinct. The precinct lines are not done, they're done by the Board of Elections, mm-hmm. is that right? And so they're not done with any kind of idea about
county, city, division.
Yeah, it's complicated, let's put it that way.
That law was passed in 1993, and a special local legislation only applies to Alamance County. I'm not sure that's all we need to know about it. But
is it precinct or township?
Precinct.
Isn't there a
township's even worse. Townships have never been mapped, ever. They were created with the Constitution of 1868 when those northerners came down here and imposed their will on the South, and they made townships, and we had justices of the peace and all of that. But nobody ever bothered to map the township. And precincts are even worse because, as the chairman just said, some of them go through cities, and it'd be difficult to line up who gets to vote in a zoning map. And if you did that, you would have how many precincts? 16 precincts?
35, I think.
There's 36 precincts.
36 precincts? Well, then you would end up with 36 zoning ordinances.
Except for some of them are within different towns. But like Hall River precinct includes parts of Graham, includes parts of however, obviously, and then people aren't in anything.
That may not be your best option.
It's complicated. That would be a very,
very
difficult thing to
sort
out.
Yeah, figuring out who would be able to be allowed to start even trying to look at that 35% would be time consuming. Okay.
And then if somebody didn't like the results, it'd be open to a legal challenge like Boone, you know.
Probably would be. Yeah.
Very arbitrary and capricious. Sort of making it up as you go along kind of process, I would think.
Look, when you're dealing with people's rights to use their property, as you've seen from some of the speakers tonight, that's a hot-button issue for a lot of people.
Oh, I got that figured out.
Option number four is something Alamance County really hasn't played with much. Small area plans or complement the land development plan for the county and the focus on specific areas of need. So the plan specifically defines an area and adds development, such as like Snow Camp area. You have development standards to guide development for only that area. It would make it covered, it would not necessarily cover the whole county because this would be led by citizens should they be interested in planning their specific area. They define the area of what this small plan is. Where is Snow Camp? Well, we get a committee together that would include those citizens to help us define that area. Staff would work with them and move it through pretty much that same process. You have public hearings, goes to planning board, comes back to you all. Catch 22 on this is you are specific to those citizens, and you may or may not ever cover the county, because if there's a lack of interest in the southeast area, then we just won't go there, kind of thing. But it's an option.
Well, let's okay, go ahead.
Here's your map, though. This is a Guilford County small area plan. I give you all a visual on what these things look like. You probably can't see really well, but in that southeast corner, Guilford County does not have a small area plan. They, of course, only do these plans outside of everybody else's jurisdiction, so the blue is their county territory to cover. You obviously can tell they've covered chunks. Some areas are quite a bit larger than others because they were defined by the people of that area. The northeast corner is, for all intents and purposes, once upon a time they were more farming and everything, so it became larger, so larger tracts, and that's how they defined themselves. And they control themselves through these small area plans, can create their own zoning ordinances, setbacks, lot sizes, all these things can happen in these small area plans that are directly reflective of only that area of the county.
How is that managed within the area?
Well, should anybody call me and I'm regulating that northeast area for their plan, here's your setbacks, here's your lot size, and here's what you can do on that piece of property. And but if I go to the west side of the county in that little hole over there near Forsyth, they might have more urbanized setbacks. So from a planning department, county level, everybody's got a little bit different treatment. They're treating themselves the way they want to be treated. If they were part of that group, they agreed upon it, unless you were the guy that didn't like it. But the guys on the east end might have totally different regulations than the guys on the west end, or you might be the guy on the southeast who, you don't have any regulations, do what you want to, like people in Alamance.
But once the plan is in place, is there any committee or organization other than the planning department that oversees any requests for a change or
commission?
Well, once
you get that zoning in there, your planning department will take requests for change. Planning board is going to review that and give commissioners a recommendation. Commissioners make those final decisions.
Just as the cities do now, city-based.
So this is an opportunity, so for people, if you live in a community that feels strongly that they need some kind of land use regulation, this is an opportunity for those people to work together and to hear the competing concerns and to come to some kind of conclusion themselves without having been imposed by us.
Staff's going to be there to help guide the professional language. The ideas behind it are the group that was created for that area to be a community to guide what is the work going to be. But we're there to help kind of write it up and then move it through the process.
How large is Guilford County's planning board?
Planning board or planning staff?
Planning staff.
They've got a few more than we do.
Yeah, Mr. Basil, they merged with Greensboro City Planning Department and the Guilford Department.
Yeah, right. Some of this stuff is very labor-intensive.
All of that their planning department covers. If it's gray, if it's blue, they cover it all.
Labor intensive.
Very. Well, they have a whole lot more guidelines on everything compared to what we do. We'll look at the very last one is land use zone development standards. In the land development plan, you'll see that map was really old. The land development plan shows you where, like, the northwest part of the county was encouraged to be farm preservation. You get down towards the cities, you're looking more towards small residential, some commercial, industrial was pushed kind of away from those areas. And then you get back to, like, the northeast side, you're back to farm preservation. Those kind of things were written in that 05 plan. What this proposes is that you take what was proposed, and these are much larger chunks than a small one parcel zone, large acreage, you know, a couple hundred acres at a time, and you put design standards on those specific areas. So if you've got small or size residential in an area, that whole area gets those sizes. It's an 8,000 square foot lot, it's a 10 foot setback. And you go out rural, maybe your lot sizes minimums are bigger. You've got a 5 acre minimum, and you've got a 30 foot setback. But it's done in much larger groups, which means the individual lot doesn't get the attention like county lots would, or smaller area plan. But it will give you some kind of growth controls to help keep everything a little more in line with what the county would like to see growth be. Okay, well, Nia, you also go through the same thing. You go through a committee to establish that, you go through your public hearings, you go through planning board and board commissioners. These are kind of state law guidance. This isn't what we get to choose or anything. Project time frame. Land development plan, number one, we don't even want to look at anything else without doing this. It's about an 18-month time frame because it's bigger than an update. It's almost a rewrite. Option one, number one, no change. We're good to go. We can do that today because we don't have anything to do. Option number two, countywide zoning. You will start with that land development plan, and then you're going to add 24 more lots onto that. And these are all guesstimates, because should we hire a consultant, we're almost on their time frame of how fast they can work. Plus, that means a windshield survey of every piece of land in the county. Option number three, zoning by precinct. You've got the land development plan, the election cycle, and then to actually write something will probably take you about 18 months. Option number four are those small area plans. We'll start with the land development plan. In 12 months per plan, should our two-person staff get multiple requests at one time, we have to prioritize who goes first. If, in fact, we really wanted to get all the way around the county, that would take years. Option number five is land use zone development standards. Again, we're going to start with that land development update. We're going to add 18 months of that. It's about fair when you hire a consultant to get that kind of information, because they're going to go out and do some initial surveying too. Last slide, y'all. Option pros and cons. Option number one, we're not sure what the pro is, so we're just going to let y'all think on that. Cons: continued conflict between neighbors with what are reasonable expectations.
You know, if I could interrupt for a second, I would, you know, like to know if the commissioners, you know, as we go through these, if you see something that you see as a pro or a con, just kind of jump in and say, you know, what you think about it. I see a con of just doing things the way that we've been doing them, that we are left open to exploitation by these dirty businesses like the quarry. When we are, and I hope Dr. Owens will talk about this, or no, Clyde can, that we're the only county in Central North Carolina that has no real land regulation.
We're the big white spot in the center of the state.
So, yeah, so anybody who is looking to find a place to do one of these businesses will be attracted to Alamance County. So we're open to being exploited by people who want to take advantage of that. So, go ahead, I'm sorry.
No, you're fine. So the con, of course, is we're still where we're at, and we have some negative things going on at times. Countywide zoning, pro, has the highest level of certainty for citizens in county service planning. Con, citizens will have to ask the Board of Commissioners to change their zoning. So once they're given a zoning, that sticks with them unless they come before the board and ask for a change. If what they want to do doesn't fit the zoning district they're given. It costs them time, and of course, there's an application fee.
Would that go to the planning first and then get a recommendation to the board, or would it come straight to the board?
Yeah, it would come to planning department, then to the planning board, and then to commissioners. So it would get kind of a professional recommendation finish.
Right.
Option number three is zoning by precinct. This is driven by citizens. Difficult to determine, as we thought we would have a lot of complex stuff to go through to figure out who could be a part of this. And little guidance offered on what happens after the vote. How we even move forward with that. We don't have a lot in that law to help us. Small area plans, citizens in the county get to drive this. They get to decide if they would like some guidance on the growth in their area. It's difficult to determine county services and less certainty between areas of the county because one area may, you may have a lot of different things going on across the county. Number five is guidance on types of uses would help steer growth areas. So we would guide more in a large picture than a small picture. There would be more guidance than we're giving now. Not detailed on the parcel level, which is individual basis, and that's most equal across the board to do for citizens of the county. I won't say two because it is for them. It's protecting their rights, their properties, their everything. That's the end of my presentation. So any questions, discussion, and then we'll have David up just as soon as we get done.
If the county goes to zoning, don't the ETJs fall back to the county to be controlled?
No. Mm-hmm.
They don't?
They get to keep their ETJs.
Okay.
Not currently.
In number four, it says difficult to determine county services. Can you explain that?
Like EMS basis stuff, you're not controlling your growth of where your residential and everything's going to go, and where would you build, and kind of your capital plan, how all that's going to work out in the future. Whereas if you have more controlled zoning, you would be able to determine that pretty quickly.
Right.
Yeah, where are you going to put substations?
Right.
And to sort of designate an area that, we think we're going to have a substation in this small spot.
Right.
Just go.
We would love to hear what you have to say.
Ready?
Please. Yeah.
Madam Chairman, members of the board, delighted to be with you this evening. I'll try to keep this relatively brief. I realize not everybody's excited about zoning as I sometimes am. My wife frequently reminds me. But if you've got any questions, comments, observations as we go, by all means, just let me know. And if I'm going too quickly or too slowly, let me know as well. What I want to do is just give you some very basics on zoning in North Carolina, what your options are. One of the bottom lines, spoiler alert, you have a great deal of flexibility. The state law will set some required procedures and process you have to follow But what you do, how much you do, the substance of what you do is almost entirely at your discretion. State law gives you a great deal of flexibility to tailor this process to whatever you think is appropriate for Alamance County. So, what have folks done with zoning? Zoning's been around a long time. Cities have had it since 1923. Virtually every city in the state with a population of over 10,000 had zoning in the 1920s. Counties, however, had no authority to do zoning. For the most part, folks lived far enough apart that what one neighbor did with their land didn't have a significant impact on others, and counties were not involved in the zoning business, did not get that authority until 1959. Even in today, that slide's a little old. Now it's almost all cities over 1,000 have zoning. Increasingly, we have cities of 200, 300, 400 people who have their own zoning ordinance, who want to manage growth and development in their jurisdiction. And most of them have done that instead of being covered by the county or not having zoning at all. Zoning is fascinating in the sense it's extremely controversial and yet at the same time very widely used. In 1964, we only had two counties in the state that had countywide zoning, Durham and Guilford County. We're the only two in North Carolina. As recently as 1976, a majority of the counties had no zoning at all. It has gradually expanded since then. That's a 2003 map. The counties in blue have countywide zoning. The counties in red have partial county zoning. The counties in white, no zoning at all outside of the municipal areas. And you can see that pretty much corresponds, even in 2003, to population density. There's one factor that explains the adoption of county zoning more than any other factor. It's population density. As you get more people, more concerned about what their neighbors are doing. That's a considerable concern. This is the most recent map of this month. As you see, it's fairly common that counties start out with no zoning, do partial county zoning, and then gradually expand. You'll notice that counties in white with no county zoning at all are largely the mountain counties, where much of the land is either in national park or national forest ownership or in municipalities. There's very little unincorporated developable land in a lot of those mountain counties. The intercoastal plain is very rural. Most of those counties are losing population and have very little development activity underway. The number, just last week, Warren County went from partial county zoning to countywide zoning. And Warren County has somewhat had some of the same issues you've got in the sense of Northampton had no zoning. Warren had only zoning around Lake Gaston, nothing in the southern part of the county. But they were seeing some large, even though they didn't have a lot of growth and development outside the city, they had some large projects that were causing considerable concern. A coal ash disposal facility in Northampton County, in southern Warren County, somebody put in a racetrack near a residential neighborhood, automobile racetrack, which tends to be a little loud, operate on weekends.
We can relate.
So those kinds of concerns and the notion that this was going on and affecting folks' property without any regulation at all convinced even relatively small, low-growth counties to move to doing some level of zoning. Quickly say, the kind of zoning you have in Warren County is very different from what you have in Guilford or Forsyth County. A more urbanized county with high growth has a lot more detailed regulations, whereas a small county is going to have a very simple regulation with not a lot of rules, but addresses the issues of their concern. So that's where they are. The cautionary notes, what you have to be careful about. Private property rights, extremely important. Telling me what I can and can't do with property that's been in my family for multiple generations is an important concern that you will hear frequently. A concern that, well, we don't mind some regulations, but once you give politicians on the county board a foot in the door, no telling what they might enact, so there's some concern
that citizens have that you may adopt overly burdensome regulations. Concern about adding time and cost to the development process, and just governmental intrusion on private decision making. Those are all important and legitimate concerns to keep in mind as you move forward. Given those constraints, why do almost all of our counties of any size have zoning? Largely to address compatibility with adjacent land uses. The fact that, yes, people should be able to use their land as they see fit, but when it starts affecting the use and enjoyment of their neighbors' properties, you have some concern about having some reasonable rules to make sure that these things are compatible. Efficient provision of infrastructure. If you're investing in water and sewer and road improvements and the like, you want to be sure that those are wisely used in protecting the taxpayers' investments. Public health and safety issues are of concern, particularly environmental issues. Increasingly, the counties have some responsibilities there and not leaving it entirely to state decision making. Clarity of process. A good example is, Tanya mentioned you have 36, 37. And we say Alamance County does not have zoning, but when you look at a telecommunication tower ordinance, a mobile home park siting ordinance, an adult entertainment siting ordinance, there are all pieces that would typically go into a zoning ordinance. But one of the challenges when you have 30 different ordinances, the process you have to follow for amendments, what kind of notice do you give, what kind of hearing do you hold, do you send it to the planning board, there's a lot of uncertainty. And one advantage of having zoning is to wrap those kinds of provisions into a single ordinance where you have one set of procedures, one process, one set of definitions. It makes it easier for staff, for the public, for landowners, developers to know exactly what the rules and the process are. So there's some element of streamlining and simplifying if you go to a zoning or unified development ordinance that addresses those kinds of issues. In fact, zoning is a very, this is more of a personal opinion than a legal opinion, but zoning is a pretty conservative property rights oriented regulation. The main reason most local governments adopt zoning is because landowners ask for it to protect their property values. They're concerned that their neighbors may be doing things that affect their property values, and the notion that if we collectively as a neighborhood, as a community, get together and have some minimum basic rules that establishes a framework, a ground level of rules that ensure mutual respect of each other, that protects everybody's property values. Senator Sam Ervin, back before he was Senator Sam, was a North Carolina Supreme Court justice and had a zoning case in the early 1950s where somebody wanted to put a restaurant into a residential neighborhood. And the landowner's argument was, I can make a lot more money using this old house as a restaurant than I can as a home. The neighbors, of course, were not excited about conversion of a house in their neighborhood to a restaurant. And the owner's complaint was, but you're affecting my ability to maximize and use the highest and most economically productive use of my property. And Senator Ervin, in his characteristic wit, said, you're absolutely right, but zoning is the price you pay for living in a civilized society. And this notion that you can't maximize your profit at the expense of your neighbors is one of the things that's a hallmark of a civilized, those of us in zoning law like to be able to quote Senator Sam about being somewhat civilized. But be that as it is, in that respect, a relatively conservative tool in the sense of it is looking at overall property values and protecting those. Neighborhood character, you've heard tonight, different communities have different interests, different needs, different desires, and letting those communities define that character and maintaining and protecting that for their children and grandchildren is another part of sort of the conservative part of having some development regulation. Many developers find it helpful
and sense of protecting predictability in the real estate market. You know, you don't want to put in a subdivision and have some untoward development 2 months later going in across the street that affects your ability to further develop that subdivision and sell those lots. So it's frequently the real estate community is looking for these kinds of protection. I would guess half, two-thirds of the ETJ in North Carolina, the extraterritorial jurisdiction, comes about when developers, typically of large residential subdivisions, come in and say, for me to be able to develop and sell these lots, I need the protection and assurance of zoning,
right.
And the county's not in this business, so city, would you come out here and provide that so that I can tell folks I'm selling lots to what to expect over the next 5, 10, 15 years, if they're going to put their life savings in my development, I want to be able to assure them that it's going to be a good investment. So enhancing those kind of community values is another factor that often goes into this. Just as close to wrapping up, each ordinance is unique. You can define how many districts you want, how strict your regulations are or not. Buncombe County just adopted countywide zoning maybe 5 years ago. Asheville's had zoning since the 1920s. Waynesville, the other place. Buncombe had not. But they decided they needed it. Very controversial. Some of my no zoning signs were from Buncombe County. But their zoning for the relatively rural, undeveloped part is very permissive. They say there's some areas, some of our major transportation corridors, commercial areas we need to regulate very carefully. There's some land uses, high impact land uses we need to regulate very carefully, but otherwise we don't need a lot of rules. So they have relatively simple rules for most everything in their rural residential part of the county. Others have much more detailed rules. So you decide which kinds of rules you want or don't want. Just highlight a couple of quick process rules. The state does have detailed standards on the process you have to follow, mainly to make sure the county commissioners don't do anything without careful, deliberate consideration, because you are affecting people's property rights. So in order to adopt a zoning, you must go to a public hearing, you must have newspaper notice of that hearing, you must send it to the planning board for review and comment, and you must make a statement as to why what you've done is reasonable and in the public interest before you take any action on zoning. As I say, detailed notice on the hearing. The first notice has to be in the newspaper at least 10, but not 20, more than 25 days prior to the date of the hearing. Second notice has to be in a separate calendar week. It has to be in a newspaper, general circuit. But all of those kinds of process rules just make sure the public knows what you're thinking about doing, has an opportunity to comment on it before you do it. Posted notice when you're doing a zoning map amendment. You have to put a sign up on the site to let people know about the public hearing so they can look at it and say, we need to call the planning department and find out what's going on so we can get to the hearing. We can send our commissioners a letter and talk about that. There are a couple of things you cannot do. County zoning cannot affect bona fide farming operations. That has been in the law since 1959.
That's a good law. That's a good law.
Part of the political compromise when counties asked to get zoning in 1959, the legislature said, fine, but you can't use zoning to affect farming. Covers all sorts of farming. Farming is defined very broadly. Agriculture, horticulture, silviculture, aquaculture. So if it's a commercial greenhouse, a fish farm, tree farm, that's all covered. Agritourism is the currently controversial issue. It's not controversial when somebody wants to do hay rides or a corn maze. It's folks who do event space primarily and are doing weddings, retreats, and sometimes the rural neighborhood is a little concerned that somebody's built a barn and is holding weddings for 500 people with a dirt road and they're right next to their neighborhood, and the commercial operator of that facility claims they are agritourism, even though there's no farm there. So the bounds of how far agritourism extends is a hot button issue around the state. For some reason, wedding venues and retreats are what gets the most attention. The legislature has also clarified that residential use on a farm is exempt from county zoning if the residence is occupied by the owner or operator of a farm. So housing on a farm is not going to be, cannot be subject to county zoning, and incidental farm uses, selling farm products, so forth and so on. Couple of other things you cannot do. I just mentioned one to highlight. You can regulate manufactured homes, but you may not totally exclude manufactured homes from your jurisdiction. You can regulate their size, their dimension, and their location, but not their age, value, or do a total exclusion of manufactured housing. But apart from farm protection and total exclusion of manufactured housing, what you do and how you do it is up to you. And any of the options that were presented to you earlier are procedures you can use. And there are counties that have done virtually all of those. Some have done sort of voting precinct. That is, I think, unique to Alamance County. But Watauga County, for example, has a process that a community, Valley Cruces, for example, or Snow Camp, is that if the residents of this area come and ask for it, we'll do zoning for them, but we're not going to impose it on another part of the county that has no interest or need. And so they have three or four areas that folks have petitioned to be zoned, and they have zoning there. Warren's a good example. They had zoning around Lake Gaston where they had development, not in the southern part of the county, until they started getting some large uses, and the citizenry asked for zoning, and just last week they did so. So you have those kinds of options. The only statutory limit is that each area you zone has to be at least 640 acres, one square mile. So you can't zone less than a 640, you can't zone it parcel by parcel, unless you've got at least 640 acres with 10 different parcels and 10 different owners. But as long as you meet that minimum threshold, the size of the area, the scope of it, is entirely at your discretion.
A lot of information. Thank you much.
Certainly. If you've got any further questions.
How do you draw the line of a neighborhood like the Snow Camp area? How do you draw that line?
You have considerable discussion there. You can look at, you can talk to the residents, you can talk to the neighbors, you can use township lines if you had them, precinct lines, you can use, some folks use water bodies, highways, everything east of Chatham County for 30 years only zoned the eastern half of the county. The Pittsboro side of the county had zoning in Chatham County for 20 years, but the Siler City western end of the county had no zoning, because there wasn't much development outside of the cities going on over in that part of the county until 5 or 6 years ago. Wow. They started getting development outside of the cities and decided they needed some zoning. But so they just sort of split the county in half. You could do everything south of the interstate, north of the interstate, east of this road, you can use state road. You need sufficient boundaries that somebody would know where their property is in or out without having to hire a survey. So whatever reasonable line you want to use, typically roads, railroad lines, water courses, whatever makes sense for the particular situation you're doing.
Right, and that final, whatever you decide on, it's done by the governing body of the county, by planning, by...
Ultimately, the governing body is going to have to make the decision. You can consult with the landowners, you consult, can ask the community. We had a couple of counties that looked at, could we sort of delegate this to each local community? Burke County, when it first got into zoning, something 10 or 15 years ago was popular, land use, Lugo, it had a weird acronym, land use something, management system that basically, if a neighborhood, say Pick Snow Camp, for example, said, we want this regulation, they would take any development over a certain size and send it to the neighborhood council that would decide whether
up or down.
For it. And you can't do that. You can't delegate right. that decision-making to an unelected body. Ultimately, the responsibility rests with the elected county board of commissioners. So you can ask folks for advice. You can say, would you like this? But ultimately, it has to come to you. You will decide what those boundaries are, and you will decide what the rules within those boundaries should be. You can ask others for advice, consultation. Charlotte, for example, our largest city, for almost all of their rezonings, they do 80% of their rezonings with conditional, a tool called conditional zoning that allows you to impose individualized site plan and conditions on the rezoning. And they require as part of the application that the landowner developer meet with the neighborhood prior to submitting their request and do a summary of that meeting in there as part of their zoning application. So they define the neighborhood as 500 to 1,000 feet around the property, and those people get a letter and an invitation to come to a meeting. The developer explains what they want to do. Neighbors comment. You summarize that and put it in your application so the county, or in this case the city council, has the advantage of knowing what the neighbors think. And developers find that actually fairly helpful. If there's going to be a lot of opposition, they learn about it fairly quickly.
Oh no, I think that might send Chris Faust over the edge.
And that works for Charlotte. Yeah. That may be totally inappropriate, but if you wanted to send something to a group like that for a consultation and discussion, you could. Not required to. But ultimately, you have to make the call.
Right. If we wanted to discuss updating our land development plan, which was last done in 2005 and updated in 2007, would that need to be a separate agenda item? Could we consider, would it be timely to, if someone wanted to make a motion tonight to have that land development plan updated, should we have that as this, could we do that tonight, or does that need to be?
Well, yes. It's a lot of information being presented, whatever the board wishes to do, but that would be something that would take some time. I think the plan that was done in 2005 was done with a consulting group. I'm not sure who did it.
I think it was PTRC, perhaps.
Was it?
I think so.
It took several months to get that done.
Right.
Had a lot of community input to it.
So we would have to budget for a consultant to update the land development plan?
Yes.
So it sounds like that's a better agenda item. Maybe we could consider putting that on for February sometime? Is there sort of a general consensus that that's a good discussion to have?
Yeah, yeah, I agree.
Updating that plan, discussing updating the plan.
Has the Institute of Government or the County Commissioners Association got any avenues to follow with this?
They've always got good news and bad news to give us.
Well, I think we've worked with the School of Government very closely. We're very glad to have David Owens with us tonight, because I know Tanya has worked with him, and he is expert on land use. So we do work with them. We have questions about land use, the Association of County Commissioners also, but particularly the School of Government provides us a lot of guidance. And I think if we were to get into updating our land development plan, we certainly want to have discussions with the School of Government. And last time we did use it, we're PTCOG, and now PTRC, they work with us to do that too. So that might be a resource we could tap also.
And Professor Owens has written the book on it for North Carolina.
Yes.
He's not charging us to be here tonight. If you are, you're going to be disappointed.
No, you're close enough that we don't.
Thank you.
This is part of our standard service. But we're not in the consulting business of writing plans or writing ordinances, but we can review, comment, advise, assist. And in North Carolina, what you do with a plan, again, is something you have a lot of discretion with. We're probably the largest, fastest growing state that does not have a state mandate about planning. Whether you do a plan, what you do with it, how you use it is entirely up to you. So there's some counties that do a very high quality detailed plan, lots of technical analysis, lots of citizen engagement, and it takes time and money to do that, and often consulting services. Others do a less expensive and less time-consuming process. But it's up to you as to how much effort you want to put into the plan and the quality you want to get out of it.
If you were to do a really detailed plan, how much time do you think we're talking about? Or is that possible to estimate?
Well, time is, it would give you a better estimate.
About 42 months. Drive that
wagon. But the, again, highly variable. A year is sort of a standard process. Chapel Hill, for example, had a 20-year-old comprehensive plan and updated it. Hadn't been done in 20 years, so they just started from scratch. And they said, we want this to be a really high quality, lots of citizen engagement. They took about a year and a half, 2 years, and spent a lot of time and money. But they were using that to say, we want this to not only guide our development regulations, but our public investment policy. We want every department in the city, before you ask for a budget increase, it has to be show us how it advances the goals in our plans. So they used it as a broader priority setting for all of town government, whether it's transit, public utilities, public safety, as well as just development regulation. And that's sort of the Cadillac version. And it took them 18 months to 2 years and a lot of money.
But they already had a plan in place.
They did. But and I've seen other local governments do it in 6 to 9 months with a modest amount of efforts. But it's depends like many other things, the more time and money you put into it, times usually the better quality you get.
Yeah. Let me ask you a question. First of all, have you been here before? You've been here before over the years, haven't you? Have you ever spoken here before?
Probably.
Because you look so familiar, I just want to ask if you remember what that was. By chance.
Don't tell me I look like Roy Williams.
You better look at him.
That's what I tell folks.
Well, a technical question. Chatham County has got, I guess, countywide on it, right?
Chatham?
Yes.
Chatham just went to countywide about 2 or 3 years ago. They were eastern half of the county up until then.
Now, don't they have a 2,500 home development?
Chatham Park.
Yeah, Chatham Park in Pittsburgh.
2,500 homes or 25,000 homes?
I think it's 25,000.
It's
large.
It would be, it's huge. When built out, it's like 50,000 people.
Yeah.
I'm old enough, when I started in this business, a 100-lot subdivision was a big development. In North Carolina now, we're seeing 1,000, 3,000-lot subdivisions fairly routinely. Around the state and areas that thought they weren't going to get much development. Pittsburgh used to be a fairly sleepy little community, but basically Cary and Southern Wake has just pushed over into that. And in the 20th, Cary was a town of 5,000 people when I first moved to the Triangle. It's now 160,000 people. Change can happen a lot more quickly than we think.
Do you think zoning has promoted that or made it easier or made it tougher for it to not be bigger?
I suspect zoning has very little impact one way or the other on the rate of growth and development. It affects the type of development and the quality of that development. But it's the market forces really dictate how much development you're going to get and how quickly you get it more than anything else. And zoning largely reacts to the development pressures you've got. Like most other things, like building roads, building schools, we tend to start worrying about it after the crisis hits. Why should we have to have a development regulation in anticipation of what might happen? More often than not, in my experience, local governments, it's sort of, well, one horse is out of the barn, maybe we should start looking at this before more horses get away. And it takes things happening that have negative impacts to generate the interest, the will, the willingness to spend the time and money and sit through long, laborious, labor-intensive zoning meetings. when you get into this business, it takes time and effort to try to decide what is the right thing to do and how do we balance economic development and resource protection and neighborhood interest and small town interests. These are all ultimately value choices for you to make rather than technical things that you can turn over to an engineer or a designer. And so it becomes labor intensive for boards, for elected boards, for planning boards. If you've got growth and development, wrestling with how you best deal with those takes time and energy and effort to get it right.
It's my experience just seeing development across actually the state. It depends on the municipalities a lot too, because they're not willing to put infrastructure in. We don't do water and sewer. Our county has no water and sewer department. And it is driven by the municipalities a lot. How do we control that part as they push further out?
Well, certainly, if the county has zoning, subdivision, and building code, you have to have building code, you've already got subdivision, but you don't have zoning, so you have deferred that decision to the municipality.
Right.
If the county had zoning, then the municipality has to get the county's approval before they can do any extension of their extraterritorial area.
Okay, maybe that's what I had in mind.
The question earlier about was, would the ETJ go right away if the county adopted zoning? No, because you didn't have zoning, so they didn't have to get your approval
they
in the first place.
They just went on out and did.
But to change that, they would have to come get your approval. And you can discuss it and negotiate with them, and whether you do or don't, and a lot depends on, is it going to be annexed, or are they going to get water sewer, what kind of services are they going to have. But the county's a part of that discussion if you have zoning. But if it's an unzoned area, you can read about it in the newspaper.
I would suggest, since this is our first agenda item that we spent this time on, which is important. I mean, this is a critical question. People keep coming to us with questions and concerns. It's our duty, I think, to investigate and ask and to learn about the different options available. I would suggest or ask the other commissioners if y'all would be interested in learning more about maybe the small area plans, and what's the name of the land use zone?
Land use zone.
Option number 4 and option number 5.
Yeah, I think
I found those
to
be personally intriguing. If you are interested in more information about one of the other options or discussion about that, we can have another agenda item to do sort of a deeper dive on these things. I thought it would be good tonight to sort of let's open the book and start reading about it, start to learn as a community about what's possible, what can we do, and just going forward, having a lot of public input and public discussion about the different options. What do y'all think about that?
I think we need to consider more. I think those.
Yeah, I like the option number 4. I don't think we need to put the whole county in my opinion.
Not break it down to the parcel level, but the kind of overview of it, which is what 4 is. Or, yeah.
I would tend to agree. And Tanya, do you feel like you could come back maybe in February with more information about sort of the technical, how do you put in some of these things, more of the technical considerations?
The process of it.
Sure. Okay, definitely.
And as you proceed, if we can be of any help or assistance, I hope you'll call on us.
Thank you.
Thank you,
Thank you so much. And maybe in the meantime, we can get with, TCOG?
PTRC.
Yeah, and find out if they're available to help us with that. Thank you very, very much. How are we doing, fellow students? You have recess? Okay, we'll take a short 5-minute recess, please. Going through our agenda, the next item is the discussion of the heavy industrial development ordinance moratorium. Mr. Haygood.
Good evening, commissioners.
As been discussed this evening on December 13, 2018, the Alamance County Planning Board recommended that the County Board of Commissioners consider instituting a 59-day moratorium on all permit applications under the county's heavy industrial development ordinance. So if the Board of Commissioners wants to consider implementing a moratorium, there will be a requirement for the setting of a public hearing, which would be on February 4th, 2019 would be our next opportunity to do so. So this time it's up to the board to discuss the need for that moratorium, try to answer your questions if you have any. So.
Okay, excuse me, I'll just jump in. Why 59 days? Can we do a 60-day or more moratorium? And do we have to decide that tonight? Can we have a public hearing on just generally? I guess we do, because the
if you have something more than 60 days, then you have to have two notices published by statute.
So can we decide tonight to have a more than 60-day?
You can certainly plan for that, notice for that, and if the board hears the facts and at the hearing decides they don't want a 60-day or greater, you can decide what kind of moratorium you want at that time.
So we can go to 90 days.
You will have noticed for a longer period of time.
Do we have to notice for a specific period of time, or do we notice for 60 days or more?
Well, the statute says 60 days or more. It doesn't say that. The notice published for 60 days or less is one notice, single notice. 60 days or more, two notices.
And we have time to meet the...
Yes.
The longer notice requirement if we vote tonight to set the public hearing.
Yes, you do.
You need a motion that we go to 90 days?
No.
Well, it's a motion for a public hearing.
Yeah, we would be seeking a motion for to set a date for a public hearing of February the 4th to consider a moratorium on the heavy industrial development ordinance of the board. The motion would say 60 either days. 60 days or more.
Yes.
Or
it would be
days
under 153A, 340H, it would be a temporary moratorium.
Say that again, Clyde.
It would be a temporary moratorium on the heavy industrial development ordinance to allow planning board review and suggest any changes. What it does, it puts the brakes on any additional heavy industry ordinance if the board decides to do that at the February 4th meeting.
I'll second.
So is your motion for a 60-day or more?
60-day or more.
Yeah. Moratorium? Okay. So we have a motion and a second. Do we have any discussion?
No, I just think we need to take the pause and figure out where we're going with this.
Definitely. There's a lot of work to be done on that. So if there is no discussion, all in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Anyone opposed? Great, so we will have a hearing on February 4th, a public hearing on whether or not to have a moratorium that is 60 days or more. Okay, next item, please.
So this item doesn't require any action, but I thought it would be appropriate to talk a little bit with the board about if we're going to change the heavy industrial development ordinance, what those changes might look like. At the January 10th planning board meeting, the planning board has had an opportunity to review this ordinance. They've looked at ordinances from multiple counties that are similar to the one that we have. They've made a couple of recommendations for the board to consider as part of the process of revising the ordinance. One is that the permit approval process, currently the planning director signs off on the applications. Planning board has recommended that be changed. Their actual recommendation was to run that process through the planning board and ultimately wind up with the Board of Commissioners. So they're interested, they saw the value in some changes to the approval process for permits. And also for the planning board has also recommended notification of adjacent property owners 14 days before the review of the permit, basically saying that there was a need to change the ordinance to allow for greater public notice. County staff have taken a look at the ordinance as all this discussion has been happening. You know, our ordinance, as I think some of the public speakers mentioned earlier tonight, is a checklist form. We pretty much tell applicants, here are the things you must complete and demonstrate to county staff that you have completed for us to check off and say that you have done that. So if we're going to maintain a checklist format after listening to the public and talking as staff, we've thought about some things that could possibly be included in a revision of the ordinance. One is if there's a major utility on the property, we could require that the applicant contact that major utility and demonstrate to county staff that the utility was contacted. There are bodies of water on the property, that the applicant is aware of them. If there are any requirements from other county ordinances, they've been noted and addressed. I think one of the issues with this project in Snow Camp was that there may have been some homeowner association properties that were co-opted into the overall site. If we're going to continue to allow that, we could require that the applicant demonstrate to the county that they are meeting the terms of the homeowner association. We also would agree with the planning board that there needs to be some additional public notice. We may want to consider requiring the applicant to hold a public informational meeting in the community once the project has been applied for. There's been a lot of discussion about air and water quality and environmental quality tests. We could include those, and these will be talked about as we work on revising the ordinance. And it also has been mentioned and would be worthy of consideration for a revised ordinance that we require the applicant to list other operations that they manage. I think that's been one of the points of contention with this particular project. Also, it would be worthwhile with this particular ordinance to consider having the new revised ordinance require fire marshal office and emergency management review. Several of these projects that happen under this ordinance, like fuel, bulk, storage and chemical plants, it would be worthwhile for county departments that are involved with that kind of activity to review the plans from the applicant. So, and it could be that we could, instead of having the planning director sign the permit, could be signed by, if we're going to maintain that staff level of approval, either the county manager could sign off on the permit once it's been demonstrated that all the requirements have been met, or the planning director. But either one, what we've talked about is having that done after a presentation is made, either to the planning board or the board of commissioners, where if it were the manager sign off, the manager would be saying, here is the list of everything that has been met. It would be very open and transparent. So these are a list from the county's staff point of view that could be included as we start revising the heavy industrial ordinance. And we've received a lot of information from citizens. And many of the recommendations that the citizens have contacted us about considering to revise this ordinance mirror what I just talked about, but some of them go beyond what we've talked about as staff, the possibility of requiring the applicants to mail something to everyone within 1 mile. That's a possibility instead of just the adjacent property owners. Also, requiring a minimum 90-day permit approval was another recommendation that we've heard from citizens. Trying to look for some that are a little bit different. Considering impact to aquifers for any specific types of heavy industrial use that might impact an aquifer. And also citizens have suggested that we provide for citizen appeal in the new project. So all this to say that I think what we would like to do as staff, if the board is going to declare a temporary moratorium and then start the process for review of the ordinance, these are the things that we would be considering as staff. To draft a new heavy industrial development ordinance, we would then, during the term of the moratorium, bring that new revised ordinance to the planning board. It's possible that it may have to go to the planning board once or twice, depending on feedback from the planning board. But ultimately, the new revised heavy industrial ordinance would be brought to the Board of Commissioners for approval. So that's kind of what the process to revise it would look like. I just want to make sure that the board and the citizens, we've heard from a lot of folks about this ordinance. We want to make sure they know that we've heard their suggestions. We've taken seriously the recommendations that they've made along with the staff. So and we would examine all of those as we draft a new revised ordinance. So again, there's no action, but just to give you and the public an idea of what will happen if you decide to do a moratorium and direct us to revise this ordinance. So is there any questions?
I got somewhat of a concern on that. You know, when the city does their planning or whatever, they take it to technical review committee. Where are the road part of this deal? Where is that in this planning board looking at a project? Because if you're going to run an aggregate company, you're going to have to drive a lot of trucks in and out of there.
So the roads that are being accessed are DOT roads, state maintained. So state has input on permitting, any kind of widening requirements, that's all theirs. since we don't own any roads or anything, we don't get involved in that. Currently, TRC only is addressed in our subdivision ordinance. So TRC only comes into play during TRC.
Could we add that as a part of this?
I wonder if we could add a requirement that the applicant conduct some level of traffic study as a part of the permit application process. Is that something that could be made as a checklist?
Whatever you as the commissioners decide right. You want in the ordinance, you can.
Because I see really a big, I know the water and all that's a big issue too, but I also see a lot of big trucks going in and out of areas that they have not. And if DOT hadn't been set down with this projected plan up the front end.
And they get the same plans that we do, other than if a developer already knows they're going to have to do improvements, even just to get a truck in or something, they would already present something. But they do get plans as well as us. So not to say that that's a bad thing or anything, but we often talk with DOT. Okay. Of course, they don't got us and we don't got them, so we all have separate rule books.
I think we need to actually put that as part of this.
That's what we want to hear tonight is just to give you an overview of what we've seen from county staff viewpoint, the citizen viewpoint. Does anything stand out as something that you think we shouldn't even tackle, or is there something that we should consider and the possibility of adding some level of traffic study requirement to an applicant, maybe something that we could add to the permit process, but at least require that they demonstrate to the county we have looked at how many trucks we think per day would be coming in and out of this facility.
How many bridges we're going to cross down there.
Yes. I agree with Eddie on that.
Yeah, that's right.
Well, I'm going to throw a real balloon out there. You know, I know it's going to be generic, but can we, due to aesthetics or quality of life, a decision based on management and or the board or and planning, can we say we don't want you here? And based it on quality of life, we feel it's too much of a change for us or aesthetics of the county and or that area. You know, I know that's broad and generic and possible.
I think what I've understood in the discussions with staff is because we don't zone and we really rely on these ordinances and we need to try to keep them as checklist oriented as possible, so it's very clear to the company and the citizenry what it takes to come here. So I don't know if it's possible to venture very far off into making decisions about through the ordinance about what kind of industry you want or don't want. Correct me if I'm wrong, Clyde, that might be something that's maybe better done through some of the options that we've heard talked about.
That's better handled in a zoning situation, because you get into trouble when you make statements of aesthetic and quality of life issues, because that's so nebulous. With our current heavy industry ordinance, we're spreading the love all over the county. Because if you meet the spacing requirement, you can do whatever you want to as long as you meet that spacing requirement. And zoning, as Dr. Owen said, we put these industries and businesses where they logically belong.
I think that's what I've taken away from this process is if you want that ability to make those kind of decisions that are judgmental and is this what we want or not want, that's a zoning of some level, whether it's small area plan limited to one neighborhood or community or countywide. But as long as we're operating under the ordinance form of regulation, it really should stick to the checklist model. But from what I've understood, discussions with staff, you can add many, many things to the checklist. Traffic studies, if air quality
water
tests.
Water usage.
Yes, if water
that's
usage.
That's a big, we have hot winters, hot summers. Yes. And most of the time we don't get the rain we've been having. And those people are going to run out of water this summer.
Yes.
I'll be surprised if they don't.
So I agree, and I think many of the things that the citizenry have suggested and we've looked at, while it would not have prevented this quarry coming, they would have had to have met all these multiple requirements and maybe gone to some length of assuaging the fear in the community if people can see what other operations that they have run in the past. If there's a meeting required for the applicant to hold in the community where they come to the community on their own and say, here's who we are, here's our plan for your community and talk, rather than the way that it's panned out now.
I understand that the planning board's recommendation for the process of issuing the permit, they envisioned that the planning director would make sure that the requirements of the permit have been met, And then the planning director would do a presentation before the planning board, which would then issue a recommendation or vote on a recommendation to the commissioners. And then we would have another level of review at this body to consider de novo, fresh off, you know, look at each one of the requirements to make sure that they've been met. And I would suggest that instead of doing that, and I understand that the planning board does have the authority to make a decision about whether or not the requirements of the permit have been met. I think it would be a better use of this board's time, as we see our meetings, you know, we have a lot of issues to talk about from a lot of different parts of, you know, the county. The planning board, if they have the authority to affirm the decision of the, or disaffirm the decision of the planning director, that would be after the public has been given notice of the planning board's meeting. They've gotten 14 days notice. The public can come and observe the planning board going through the permit process and making sure that each of the elements of the permit have been met. Then that would be an appropriate use of the planning board as far as county government.
You're doing the same thing with the Board of Equalization Review. When the tax administrator says your property's worth $10 million and the property owner says it's only worth $5 million, you've delegated that to the Board of Equalization Review. And they look at the tax administrator's decision and say yes or no.
I think as long as we continue to operate under the ordinance form of regulation, then at some point, someone is just going to be looking at the list of requirements and saying, did they do it or did they not do it? That's what we had done. It was done at the planning director's level. If we bring it out from planning and either have that done, say, at the planning board, it will require county staff to be before the planning board in public, laying out all the steps that the applicant has taken and demonstrating that they have all been met. By that time, if there are any questions about any of the steps that are required in the ordinance, it would have to be addressed before it ever went to the planning board to be reviewed. So
that would preserve the due process rights of the applicant, but also give the public an opportunity to be heard and to be satisfied that the requirements of the ordinance have been met without bringing it into the commissioner meeting room where we have a lot of...
It certainly is possible if the board chooses to go that way.
Maybe an appropriate delegation, as you said.
Yes.
I think those are the processes, and along with these checklist items that we would factor into the revised version of the ordinance, and then bring to the planning board, and then bring to you. So all that would be laid out, everything required by the applicant, and then what the process would look like. Also,
yeah, I don't think any of us want to have our citizens blindsided like that.
Yeah, absolutely.
Not only will we buy outside the table,
but it's also good for transparency for the citizens to be able to see that the requirements of the permit have been met. I did like Dr. Ulickney's suggestion about requiring full disclosure of the corporate entity, mm-hmm. that the applicant right. shouldn't just be a P.O. box in Wyoming, mm-hmm. that we should know who their board of directors are these people, and that there should be some kind of mechanism to find out, do they have safety violations in another jurisdiction?
What I would say to the public, because I know we have a lot of folks here that have a vested interest in this, is, you know, they would be able to see the revised version of the ordinance before the planning board meeting where it starts to be reviewed, so they could, it'll be on the county's website, you'll be able to see it, download it, comment to us on it, what you think about it. Come to the planning board meeting, comment there. So we'll try to make it as transparent as possible for everyone. We've certainly appreciated the work that was put into giving us suggestions for items that should be considered. That took a lot of time and was done very well, I thought. So we want to go through all of those along with our own ideas about what would make this ordinance better, and then run it through a process that you can participate in. So.
Well, great. Well, this was just for information tonight, right? We don't have a vote on this agenda item. So, is there anything else that y'all about that? Okay. So, next, our sheriff.
No.
We have some inmate contracts, I heard.
Ma'am. Good evening, commissioners. I'm here tonight to talk to you about the contracts, U.S. Marshal and ICE program. Let me say this. In 1972, I took the oath of office.
Under that oath, I swore to protect the citizens of my county, my state, and my nation against all domestic and foreign enemies. And I feel like tonight that asking what I'm going to be asking commissioners for is for that reason. I want to thank our county manager, our finance department for working with me, coming up with the numbers on what we're going to be asking for tonight. But something bothers me tonight. When Ms. Powers got up here, she made a statement. We must look after our citizens first.
She's right. We do need to.
That's exactly right. And that means against any foreign or domestic criminals. I sat there and thought about Newman, California, Officer Corporal Ronell Singer that was killed, murdered for the wife and family. I thought about Adam Jobbers Miller shot in the head in Fort Myers, Florida, and I could go on and on and on. The people that we're trying to hold here are criminal, illegal immigrants that is actually raping our citizens in many, many ways. 19 overdose deaths last year just in Alamance County. Hundreds all over the nation. Why? Because of the narcotics coming across the border. The heroin traffickers that are here in Alamance County. I intend to keep that oath that I took in 1972. I'm very serious about that. And with that, I am asking commissioners tonight to look after my detention officers and make it available to the Immigration and Customs Enforcement to hold ICE inmates that has, one, violated the law when they crossed the border, and two, come into the United States and victimized our citizens. I'm asking y'all to help me do that tonight here. That's not a hard thing to ask. The jails are full all over this nation of immigrants, criminal immigrants, not the people just crossing the border, but the people that are coming here for a reason to victimize our children, our citizens, with drugs, murders, rapes, robberies, you name it. And some of the people, including sheriffs in this state and nation, is saying, well, that's not my problem. It is their problem. They swore to uphold the law. Whether we like the law or not, we took an oath to uphold that law. Please help us tonight do that here in Alamance County. I can't control other parts of the state. But as long as I'm wearing this badge, we're going to do what I took the oath of office to do if I stay sheriff in Alamance County. With that, I'm going to turn it over to our county manager with the proposal tonight. Thank you.
Thank you, Sheriff. So, in order for the Sheriff's Department to hold United States Marshal and ICE inmates, the Sheriff needs to add an additional $2,835,046 to the detention center budget. So, you have in your packet a list of the personnel, the equipment, and the materials that the Sheriff's Department would need to add. It's a total of 30 positions and various amounts of equipment and vehicles. And this, everything you see here from the ICE program was a direct recommendation from ICE when they came to visit the Sheriff's Department and reviewed the Sheriff's operation. So in order for the Sheriff's Office to hold ICE inmates, they have to provide these equipment and personnel. We've also included in this list a retention plan for Alamance County detention officers. You can see that on the handout in your packet. This retention plan for the detention officers includes a 3% salary increase for all detention officers ranked sergeant and below. It also would allow for a separation allowance to be paid for detention officers. This is a benefit that we would offer to hopefully attract people. Detention officer is one of our highest turnover positions in county government. It's obviously a very difficult job to do. We're trying to make it more attractive. So we're currently under statute by the state to provide separation allowance for sworn officers. We feel like offering separation allowance for detention would be a good recruiting tool. The way it would work is someone would have to work for Alamance County government for 15 years and retire from Alamance County government to be eligible. So if you came here and only worked for a few years and left and went somewhere else, you would not. The idea would be to try to attract experienced new detention officers and encourage the detention officers that we have to stay with us and continue to work for the county. So the sheriff is engaging in negotiating a per diem rate with the United States Marshal and ICE at this time. And what I've talked with the sheriff about is the new rate, the new per diem rate needs to cover all these expenses. What we want for U.S. Marshal and ICE to do is we combine those per diem rates that this entire $2.8 million is covered by revenue that we would charge U.S. Marshals and ICE. So my goal from the financial perspective would be to cover all these costs with money from the federal agencies that would be housing inmates with us. So we do not have those rates yet. We don't have them negotiated yet, and we don't have signed contracts. But what I would suggest to the commissioners is once we know what those rates need to be, the sheriff is already engaged in negotiating with both U.S. Marshals, which were almost complete with U.S. Marshals.
That is complete. It's just a matter of them coming back to work, sending the contract down the same.
That's correct. And we have begun the negotiation process with the ICE.
ICE. It went to them today, and we'll probably know something by tomorrow.
So once we get, if ICE in particular will agree to the rate that we're proposing per diem, then that will provide enough revenue to cover these costs. What I would ask the board to consider this evening is voting to approve these budget needs that the sheriff has outlined, this $2.8 million, contingent on the fact that we would negotiate rates with U.S. Marshal and ICE and have signed contracts to cover those costs. So at this time, I'll certainly be happy to try to answer any questions, and I'm sure the sheriff would be too.
Let me ask a question. Now, you know I support this, but I wonder if anything's been left out of the per diem. You know, 15 and a half years ago, to give you a little background, not any person sitting up here on this board or anybody in this room, but Terry and myself that went to Alabama, 15 and a half years ago, this is how long this debate's been going on. And our government still hadn't done it. Terry Johnson, Jail Director John Clay, Commissioner Larry Sharp, Tim Sutton, County Manager David Cheek, Assistant County Manager Jeff Causey, Chief Probation Patrol Officer Steve Neighbors, and we flew down to Columbia and got the architect and went down to Edwards County, Alabama. Now back then, INS felt like they needed to pay for some of the capital, wear and tear, use, so forth and so on. And I'm wondering if this per diem has any consideration for the wear and tear on our facilities, the yes, capital.
It does.
Can you explain that?
Actually, Susan, I don't want to put you on the spot, but Susan has been engaged.
Appreciation, all that is covered in this per diem.
So, Susan, I don't know if you can enlighten the board just a little about that.
With the ICE contract, what we have done is we've provided a list of expenses we're working with the Summerall Group based out of Washington, D.C. to help us formulate these expenses. And we are able to claim our indirect cost, which looks at building depreciation. And if on the list before you tonight, there are some added costs for some capital improvements that would need to be made to the jail facility.
Better than I thought it was.
Okay. Well, I like it. You're liking it better now, right?
Knowing you like I do, do you think I'll hang you out to dry? No.
Well, it's not me, but it's hanging us out to dry if we don't get some capital consideration.
I totally agree with you. The current rate that has been negotiated with the Marshal Service was $66.95. And current rate, and they've agreed upon, is $82.07 per day per inmate. The Marshal Service, and I'll just tell you right up front, we've asked for $155.34 because their standards on what we have to do is much higher than the U.S. Marshal standards. They sent a team out here to go through our jail, and everything that's listed that you have on your list they said we had to have and put it in the per diem. It was figured by our finance department and our Joe Summer in Washington, D.C., and been submitted. It was submitted this afternoon over to Mr. Quigley with ICE, and we should know something within probably the next 24 to 48 hours.
And we figured this, we've also figured the funding stream based on a commitment from ICE for 50 beds. No matter how many folks they may send us, what we're asking them to consider is pay us that per diem rate based on 50 beds, even if they're sending us less folks. If they send more folks to the Sheriff's Department, they would pay for the additional. If they send less than 50, they pay for 50.
So that, it's a guarantee.
It's a guarantee 50 beds. If they put 10 in there or 60 in there, they'll pay for 60. If they put 60, if it's 10, they still pay for 50.
That's what we have asked them to consider, the rate the sheriff mentioned, and guaranteeing the revenue that would come from a guarantee of 50 beds. So again, this evening, what we're asking is for you to approve this budget contingent on these rates. If you do that, and the sheriff's successful in negotiating these terms with ICE, then I would be back in front of you as soon as that happens at the next available commissioner's meeting with a budget amendment for you to actually approve to put the money into the detention center's budget.
So the vote tonight would be to approve that the Board of Commissioners will amend the sheriff's budget if the sheriff can negotiate rates to cover these costs.
Yes.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second on that.
Wait
for the discussion.
Well, number one, I know you have a lot of deputies here. I want to thank each and every one of y'all.
I have some fine officers with the Alamance County.
Thank y'all.
Thank you for your service.
Thank y'all. You got a hard job. We appreciate you.
It's true.
All right, if there's nothing further, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed?
Thank you.
Okay, we have some policy clarifications for our personnel handbook.
Commissioners, this item does not require a vote, but what we're trying to do is bring our personnel manual up to speed to reflect our actual practices. Again, there is no vote needed. What I'm attempting to do this evening is make you aware as a board of our practices and the updates we're about to make. We will distribute new copies of the personnel manual to county employees. It will be dated January 22nd, 2019, so we have a baseline for the employees to know when this manual was issued. And I've also asked the Human Resources Department before June 30th of this year to complete a review of the entire manual for best management practices. So this is just getting our policies in line with what we're actually doing in print, but we will review them before the end of the year and update them for best practice. The department heads and the county legal department will both be involved in that process and have opportunity to comment on all possible changes to the personnel manual. And we'll bring that to you before June the 30th. Very quickly, unless you have questions, I'm going to just briefly touch on these changes or the clarifications that we're making. Vacation accumulation policy, we have new software that allows us to apply new accumulation rates on January 1 instead of anniversary dates. On anniversary dates instead of January 1. I'm looking serious, you're shaking her head. We're also clarifying the manner of taking leave. We're going to put in our manual that vacation leave must be pre-approved and that we do not allow people to take leave if they have no balance. We're doing that now, but we're going to put it in writing. Sick leave accumulation, we will clarify that employees who work 12 or 24-hour shifts earn sick leave at 8 hours, not at 12 hours or 24 hours. That is our practice. We're also going to put in the manual that employees may request voluntary shared leave, if they're taking care of dependent children. That is our current practice, but not in the book. In the book currently, the former longevity pay policy is still in our book. We are taking that policy language out. We are inserting the service bonus award program that we currently manage. We'll be putting that language into the manual. We're also going to clarify our hazardous weather leave policy that indicates employees will not receive hazardous weather leave if they are on vacation when the winter event comes. So if somebody's on vacation and we get a snow day and we're delayed for 2 hours, they will not get, and that's how we do business now, but that is not reflected in our manual. We're also going to correct the manual to reflect what we're doing about overtime in a declared state of emergency. We changed that policy a year ago more to become compliant with FEMA, so we would be eligible for FEMA reimbursement in the event of a state of emergency. And we're also, the final item, going to change, clarify our sickness and disability, that employees will be allowed to use vacation and sick leave to cover the 7-day waiting period for workers' comp. That is our practice, but the book doesn't reflect it. So, again, this doesn't require any action. I wanted to be sure, though, that we keep these things in front of you. I think you will see me back about the personnel manual. We're going to try to keep it up to date and accurate for employees. And so I will be back about a couple of things that we're still working on. But in the meantime, if there's no questions, that's the extent of this item. So.
Great.
Thank you.
Does anybody have any questions? All right. Thank you so much. All right. We have an amendment to our rules of procedure, I believe, related to our public comment period, Mr. Albright.
Yes. the chair asked me to take a look at this. Ask the board to consider adding a second period of comment at the end of the meeting. And if you approve the resolution, the speaker would be heard during the first comment period on agenda items and the second comment period on any topic of public interest. And we would make that a formal change to our policy, and that would be appear in paragraph one of our policy as it currently exists, the public comment policy. We'd also change our rules of procedure to reflect the change in the agenda, paragraph 5, agenda section 2. We would add that as a new Romanette 8, speakers from the floor to the end of the meeting, if it's the board's wish to do that. And I believe you have two resolutions before you that would affect that.
Yes, I asked that this be on our agenda and that we consider this, because we had, I believe, at least two times. Well, we had one time last year when we had people come and use the public comment period, which is limited to 30 minutes. However, commissioners' responses can take more time than that. We're not really considering the commissioner response time to be part of that 30 minutes for the public comment period. And so then we had, I don't know if y'all remember, that we had a couple of things that the director of Parks and Rec had asked to be on the agenda, which then had to be postponed because people were using the public comment period time for things that were unrelated to business, which was actually pending before the body. And I think that is important, that we make sure that business gets taken care of. That's the department head thinks it's important enough to ask the county manager to have it put on the agenda, then we should make sure that it gets done. So that is the reason that I'd ask for that, and I welcome your feedback.
I think it's fine. We tried that one time before, but couldn't get board consensus on it, so, but I'd be fine with that, to do that, because I agree with you. A lot of times you're holding up other people, too.
I'm okay with that, too.
I'm just tickle pain.
What, you need a motion?
Yeah.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to amend our rules of procedure to reflect two comment periods. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay, and the hand in hand with the rules of procedure is our public comment policy.
Yes, the second resolution is before you to amend that policy.
Just to reflect that same change.
Yes, to add, to have two periods. One, that the first comment period will be limited to items on the agenda, and the second comment period will be items of general interest to the public.
Can they double dip?
If they're of general interest to the public, yes. But if they just want to talk about the price of tea in China, you may want to put a stop to that.
Well, I think that is still in the discretion of the chair.
It is.
Take it offline. Do we require people to sign up for the second comment period?
Well, I'm not sure. Well, yeah, I mean, you don't just open the floor, whoever wants to say something. Yeah, you have to put the
But we'd be here all night.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's for sure. Let's sign up.
Yeah.
Yeah, and they need to know, were they doing agenda item or non-agenda item?
And each, if you look further, each public comment, each is limited to 30 minutes.
Trying to tell us that we should do, let them sign up for it.
Yes, and each is limited to 30 minutes. It's in right, the proposed change.
Okay.
So that's an hour.
Limit to 30 minutes.
Yes, you're going to have 30 minutes before and 30 minutes after.
3-minute limit would limit us to 10 in each session, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's right.
I'll make a motion when you move that.
I'll second that.
Awesome. We have a motion, a second. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay. We have an ADA compliance presentation by Mr. Keith, our inspection specialist. And this is for information, correct? Not for a vote?
Mm-hmm. Informational presentation. Good evening, and I'd like to welcome Commissioner Carter. We have a breakfast thing tomorrow going.
Yes,
30. I think we're going to meet. But I won't say congratulations, I'll just say thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah. Brian Haygood asked me to update the board on the status of our county buildings, county-owned buildings, as regards their ADA compliance. You know, we all want to provide services to people with disabilities, and so this is aimed at that. A lot of what is driving this is an initiative by the Department of Justice called Project Public Access. They are auditing local governments to make sure that that citizens are not being denied access to services. And so we're doing pretty well. I'd just like to preface this by saying there have been a lot of good changes already to the buildings. There are some areas of non-compliance, but a lot of good work has been done. For example, this building has a fully compliant entrance ramp. It's very good. Our building across the street has like one or two minor issues, but overall it's excellent. Nice restrooms that are fully handicapped accessible. So here's what the Department of Justice is looking for. They want an accessible route, and what that means is that I can get out of my special van, get in my wheelchair, roll into the building, and get to the service that I need, the primary function of the building. Accessible restrooms are required where facilities are provided, and that's important for us because we have some buildings that are buildings we don't want to put a lot of money into right now that don't have a compliant restroom. Environmental health is one. But if we do, it's a short duration there. People are there for 15 minutes or so. So if we don't provide a public restroom, then an accessible restroom is not required for the public. They also, if we get audited, they want to see that we are taking action as a county, that we've got a program in place, that there's something in the long-range capital improvements plan to deal with some of these issues. So that's part of it, and that's why it's really good. Mr. Haygood asked us also to form a committee for ADA compliance, and we have done that, and we've already met. We have to formulate a grievance procedure to deal with complaints, and then our website information, there are requirements so that people with visual handicaps can access the information. Current status, we initially surveyed them in 2016. We've revisited them again a couple of months ago. There are some improvements since 2016, but there are some things that still need to be done. The website, Scott Ward has been working on that along with other folks in IT, and has that in good shape. He gave me that. I said, so where are we with the what? He said, it's undergoing continuous evaluation and correction to ensure compliance with, that's the standard, WCAG. Don't ask me what that stands for. There are some issues with our buildings that can be resolved with a very small amount of money. Things like signage, the one at the top directs people to the nearest accessible entrance. If there are two, such as the sheriff's building, there's two entrances, only one is really accessible. So you put a sign there that directs people around to the one that they can use if they're in a wheelchair. And as we mentioned, a committee has been formed to improve compliance. Please stop me at any time if you have a question. I'm going to roll through this. I know it's getting late. Here are our individual facilities. And an important thing, the grades for each building relate to the overall condition of the building, not so much to ADA compliance. But the reason that's important is that if a building is a grade D and it needs a lot of work, well, that's, you know, decisions need to be made as to where it's best to spend the money, because like most households, we have a limited budget, right? So the county office building that we're in now and civil courts, the only issue with this building is there's a picture at the top on the right. We have parking that isn't really up to current standards. There's too much slope on the space, and the curb cut doesn't meet current standards. It's fairly usable as it is, and truthfully, I don't know what the Department of Justice would say about something that is somewhat usable but doesn't meet current standards. They are closed right now, as you're probably aware, because the government shut down. So I would have liked to have asked them that before this meeting, but I will get an answer to that.
There have been some improvements on that. Like a fresh concrete on that one cut there.
Yes. And like I said, we're not in terrible shape. Another nice improvement, the Health Services Center was already compliant. The doors that were added make it an even friendlier building for people with disabilities. Nice double doors added. They look nice and function well. Court Services Building is our building. We had some problems with the ADA spaces. They had too much slope. So we actually moved the parking to the ADA parking to the back parking lot, the church parking lot, which is much flatter and much better to use. There's a problem with the ramp at the bottom of the sidewalk. It's supposed to have a landing that's 5 feet by 5 feet. It has a landing, but it's not that big. And the problem is the sidewalk and this parking belong to the city of Graham. Mm-hmm. So to do anything about it, there has to be some kind of intergovernmental cooperation, interlocal agreement or something like that, to get that work done.
Can I ask a question about that handrail issue? What does that mean? I think I know what it means, but I'm
A handrail, even just by building code, any handrail is supposed to be continuous. It shouldn't have gaps in it. And it should turn back into to a surface so that I don't catch my jacket or sleeve on it and go tumbling down the ramp. So that's pretty easy stuff to fix, some welding, because they're metal. And a lot of the handrails, for example, at Environmental Health, have been redone and are very good now. Criminal Courts Building, parking signs have added too low. That's really not a big deal. And they've raised two of them. Buddy has, he's our facilities guy, and we are working together on doing some of this stuff. The new jail, that is probably one of the more difficult ones because it involves grade and parking spaces, and it takes a little bit of money to do the concrete and asphalt and grading work required to correct those situations. So those would be things that we would look at from a capital improvement standpoint, most likely. Sheriff's office, the main entrance is not accessible because the sidewalk, and now the sidewalk could be made into a ramp, and at that point it would be compliant. But we can just use a sign to take people around to the entrance that works. That's very easy. Part of what we talked about when we met as a committee was taking care of the low-hanging fruit and things like signage, fixing handrails. That's pretty easy, and we should be able to get it done fairly quickly. County Courthouse. A problem with street parking. County Courthouse, which building is that?
It's the historic.
The historic courthouse, yeah. So that building is very good. It has a couple of minor issues. The street parking, again, it's Graham, so we can't do too much about it. But the problem with parallel parking, you can't really use parallel parking for ADA because there's no access aisle. There's no place for me to get out unless you make a place a wide place on the sidewalk. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, you're getting out in the middle of traffic, and no one wants that. Register of Deeds building that, you know, that building gets a lot of traffic, and it's very old, and
it's one of the worst.
I think grade C is generous for that building. So it can be repaired. The side entrance that there's a picture of there could be repaired, and it could be compliant. But right now there's too much slope, and the front door goes right out onto the sidewalk. There's not much to be done there. Dental clinic has several parking problems, but they're actually fairly easy to fix. All we have to do is move the parking around to the front of the building. And I think there's already a curb cut there, so not too bad. The walk-in clinic has multiple issues, and those are all things that would require a little bit of money to fix. Those wouldn't be easy to fix, but we will look at those. Andrea Rollins has been tasked with trying to put some of this into long-range planning. Environmental health building, as you can see, the main entrance as pictured there is just, it's not really going to be easy to make that accessible, but there's an accessible entrance with a nice ramp, nice wood ramp around the side. So all we really need is a sign to direct people around there. Very simple stuff. The door threshold is a little bit too high at the accessible entrance, but it would be pretty easy to fix. Main problem there is an accessible restroom. That would be a large expense on a building that's a grade D building. That thing is a dinosaur. So those are the individual buildings. Ag Extension has a small problem with their accessible route crossing traffic. All we have to do is stripe out a walkway across there, and that would be all right. Some slope problems. The restrooms are somewhat compliant. They don't meet current standards, but they met standards at the time they were done. So again, I'm not sure what the DOJ would say about that, but I will look into it. Family Justice, the street parking. There is no way, there's no accessible route into the front of that building. The street parking is parallel parking, so it doesn't really work. It belongs to Burlington, so again, it's kind of out of our hands to fix that. And from the rear parking area, it's way too steep of a slope to get up that hill and in the front. So that building has an issue there. So some of those things, we might at some point get a design professional involved to try to figure out.
Yeah, maybe create
civil engineer to, yeah, to figure out how to do it. Ramps or parking or something. And then the ACTA building. The signs were mounted too low. I think Buddy fixed those already. The accessible route is too steep. It has too much cross slope. It's limited to, it's got to be basically flat. So again, that's a grade D building, so decisions would have to be made as to what to do with that. Elderly services, that's a grade D building. That's scheduled to be redone, right? Isn't that the building? So what's in there is coming out, and that building's going to get a full remodel, is my understanding. So I don't think we need to do too much there right now. Community corrections on Prison Camp Road, that's a fairly new building, but unfortunately they didn't do the parking lot right. The parking lot has too much slope, so it can be corrected. It just takes concrete and a little money. Former Development Services building, a little blue modular that we used to be in, is currently vacant. It's got a couple of issues, and I think the future of that building is up in the air at this point. It's not a bad building overall. The portion of the ramp that was deteriorated has been repaired, actually. I didn't note that in my presentation. But again, that wouldn't be a very difficult fix. So the challenges, we talked about some of them, the street parking issues. Many of the buildings are just have parking that's not under our control. So some improvements are going to take some money to fix. So interlocal agreements, parallel parking is not going to be a viable solution for accessible parking. So those are the challenges. The way forward, so what needs to happen for us to be completely compliant? Interlocal agreements, funding, it's got to be put in a CIP. We need work orders. The compliance committee action items are already rolling, but we want to do two things: take care of that easy stuff to fix ASAP, and then Michelle Mills has been tasked with developing a grievance procedure. She's going to help us do that, and Ben from legal is in on that too. He'll make sure that we're getting it right. That's it. Questions?
How many complaints do we get per year? I know at one time there were several coming through, but it looks like we're constantly working to improve this.
We had one on this building a year or two back, is the only one that I'm aware of, and that building is okay. The complaint, you know, we came over and measured and looked and everything, and it's fine. The building's fine. It works. The entrance is accessible.
Health department is really nice.
Yes.
Double doors.
Yeah, one of the big problems with most businesses and our buildings too is sometimes there's a limit on how much force to open or close a door, and nobody's able to meet that. I haven't seen three businesses that really
push
work.
That button,
especially if the air's on and there's some negative pressure.
Right.
Yeah. So the automatic doors are a nice thing. Anything else?
All right, thank you very much.
I know it's late and you're tired. Thank you. Thank you for paying attention.
Okay, we have a budget amendment from the health department. I guess two of them.
I do have two budget amendments for you. The first one, I think, in your packet is the Duke Endowment Grant for $65,000. This is a foundation grant, so no local match. I know we all like that. So the Alamance County Children's Dental Clinic has been awarded $65,000 from the Duke Endowment to support our dental health initiative in the schools. I think Mr. Sutton and Mr. Lashley might remember that the Duke Endowment was the funder who helped us open those doors down the road.
Sure is.
And the basic idea here is that this is a planning phase grant. The $65,000 will be used to prepare and plan for the school-based dental screenings and basic dental care. Throughout the duration of this planning grant, we'll receive technical assistance and consultation, equipment, and supplies. The idea here is if we do well in the planning phase, we'll be invited to apply for full implementation as well. So again, this is foundation grant.
Make the motion to approve.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to approve the first budget amendment. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Okay,
thank
another
you.
One.
The second one is from the Division of Public Health. This is a new agreement addenda, and those agreement addendas are contracts that we have with the Division of Public Health. And this is a new one that will allow for training for staff to act as peer review in the community health assessment and state of the county health report review. And we're receiving $1,000 from DPH to do those functions. This is state money and requires no local match.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second for approval. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed?
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Susan Osborne.
Yes, I know you thought I'm gone and I'm not back. I just have one more week, that's all. So I have tonight a new allocation received from the Division of Social Services at the state. It's for guardianship services. We receive a state allocation through Social Services Block Grant. Because of our poverty rate and the number of folks that have come under guardianship over the last 3 years, there was a new pot of money. It was allocated based on those two factors. We got a big chunk. Actually, $94,120 in SSBG, which requires a 25% match. When you put those two together, it's about $124,000. We already have matched our SSBG, that block grant. We are requesting to do the budget amendment to add a position to cover these guardianship increases that we've had. We're at capacity. We currently have 131 folks under guardianship right now. 5-6 years ago, we had 35. And the type of folks that we have for guardianship has changed, the demographics. We used to have older folks that had outlived their relatives, didn't have any children that we were making decisions for, and now we're making decisions and receiving guardianship for folks who have been determined incompetent due to mental illness, many in their 40s. We will keep them until they die. And so our caseload is growing and not turning over. So this will allow us to hire a new position. We are going to kind of revamp our process and put this person on the front end to really dig in and see if they're are other folks that can take guardianship once we stabilize the situation. And then we're going to work on the back end too to see if we can give guardianship to family members after we've got things stabilized. You know, sometimes it's really hard to tell a relative you have to leave your home. So if we can do that, and then we can work on encouraging family members with this additional staff person to take guardianship back. So that's our goal. Actually, this will all result in a net decrease in county funds offset of about $31,000 when all is said and done with this new allocation. So that's our request. To add a position, it'll be a social worker 3.
She
would pass it.
I mean, it is her last request.
Boy, that sounds.
Did you make a motion over there, Mr. Carter? Did you make a motion?
I did.
I'll second that.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to approve that request for a budget amendment. Is there any more discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed?
Thank you.
Okay. Mr. Manager, do you have a report?
Susan, I didn't have a report, but I don't know if...
I thought you two were going to talk.
No.
I will do it. Okay. Commissioner appointee to the Department of Social Services Board, I am privileged to announce tonight to the public that, we knew that Susan was leaving, and so the DSS Board has hired a replacement for her, and that is Adrienne Day.
I look forward to working with all of you.
She has a high bar to lofty example to look to, but Adrienne is a consummate professional, very experienced and knowledgeable about every aspect of the Department of Social Services, and I know she's going to do a fantastic job, and I know that Susan is going to just do great for the state of North Carolina. And her new role is as an assistant secretary.
That's right, for county operations.
For county operations for the Division of Health and Human Services.
Department.
Department of Health and Human Services. So we are so pleased. Right, so you didn't have a report?
No, just look forward to working with Adrienne. And I've so much enjoyed working with Susan too. So congratulations.
Thank you.
Adrienne gets to do a first budget.
Susan jumped ship right in time.
Oh, sure did. Do we have any commissioner comments tonight?
Nope.
All right. Well, if not, then the business of the board is being concluded. We will adjourn.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.
Meetings of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners occur on the first and third Monday of every month in the Commissioners' Chambers at the County Office Building at 124 West Elm Street in Grand. Typically, the first meeting of the month occurs at 9 a.m. and the second meeting occurs at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. The video of this meeting is broadcast on LocalGov TV. Please go to www.localgovtvnc.com for more information about this schedule and to see more videos produced by your local governments. You can also access this meeting through our website at www.alamance-nc.com or at our YouTube channel. Technical questions regarding this meeting's broadcast or production may be sent to our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. This address is for technical questions only. Comments and questions about the content of the meeting may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. There, you can click on the link that says County Commissioners to learn more about our commissioners, read minutes and agendas of commissioner meetings, and find other information about the county commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on LocalGov TV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments.